Mixed up Mother Goose.
Oh, no one liked that shit.
That happens to me sometimes.
Mm. Yeah, just as you get to that point.
It's like edging.
My ass is sufficiently tears.
Tears?
I don't know, man.
Oh, stop everybody!
Fuck.
What the fuck?
Have we learnt enough?
Oh, you put the other one.
Yeah, let's move on.
Tappies.
Thank you for building such a fantastic spam open.
Okay, good. That's
everyone needs in their life, like a little bit of tingle.
Feel super busy, feel the tippy.
What this? And he said, that's a cockroach.
Hello!
Welcome to Back Pocket for Thursday, the 15th of June, live from the Loki Studio, starring One of Us.
One of us. One of Us.
It's Ruby. Yeah! Oh my god. Just I don't know that the compressors are up to that. He's the son the Swifts never had. It's William Yates. He's the son the Swifts did had. It's Joshua Swift.
Oh, we didn't clean the kitchen before we started the show.
Awful. I think all it looks about good.
Guzman. All about awful. Guzman. The shame. The shame.
It's my wife, Stephanie Bear Dixon. I don't think I've used that before, so that's cashing it in. And me, Jeremy Sumpter, tonight on the show. Jeremy Sumpter.
Who's Jeremy Sumpter?
I pressed the wrong button.
He was the hot young boy who played Pan in the live action.
Hot young boy.
He was a babe.
He played Pan. Peter Pan.
What's he doing?
Tonight on the show, Grimace in Colour. In games galore, too many games. Cancel all games. That's what I think.
Oh, no.
We're all back. Ruby, welcome to the studio. Welcome to the team. Yeah. Welcome to the couches.
Thanks for having me in your home. It's now freaking my home.
It's your home too.
Yeah, I live here now. My bed is just around the corner. You can't see it.
No. There's a four-story bunk beds.
Yeah.
We have them here.
We all sleep in one big bed.
We're four-story, but we all sleep on the bottom bunk.
You know, like there's four in the bed and the little one said, that's like us.
We're
all in the bed. I'm the little one.
Okay.
And I never get out of the bed.
Yeah.
And you all fall out of the bed. And it's a crazy time that we all have.
How has your time been here so far?
It's been so good.
Apart from the fact that we ran out of toilet paper. Yeah. I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay. I don't need it.
All I want to say is that we had a lot of toilet paper when we left. Ruby started the week before we got back and it's all gone.
Hey, all I'm saying, look to camera, I'd be shitting. And that's on God.
I've heard you on a conversation to a family member before and you're like, oh, I'm just at work. It's good.
My mother called. She's like, is work being nice to you? And I'm like, yeah.
Like, you better say it's Bubba. Good.
Yeah, can you imagine if I was just like, yeah, Bubba. Oh, nah, it's shit. This place sucks. Anyway, bye. Show in 10 minutes? Okay.
It is awesome to have you. Sorry it's been like we were away. Came back.
Yeah.
Gus was here for a day with us all, and then he left as well. So, and you were ill last week.
Oh yeah,
so
my first.
It's been a rocky road.
My first week was also my first week of having tonsillitis.
Yeah.
I don't know why I put that in quotes. I had tonsillitis. I had it.
Now it's been thrown into question.
Yeah. You know, my fake sickness, which was totally real.
Yeah. Well, yes, it's wonderful to have you here.
Thank you for having me.
Will, you've been making new family.
I have. I went to Mickey Boobs with the Swifts.
Mickey Boobs.
Which is what he
sounded like he had a child.
Yeah.
Michael Boobs.
By the way, he phrased it.
He was adopted by another family, so he became a child.
Oh, that's what
once
you mean
more.
By the intro. I didn't know what all that was about.
Well, you're about to learn.
Yeah.
This is fucking insane.
Did you take my ticket?
Yeah, well, no, Josh didn't. His mum and dad did. They were timely down during the weekend.
Yeah, my mum and dad came to visit this weekend and
As a spur of the moment thing, you know, we're here for the last Thursday, and Will said I have two tickets, and I said, well, it's my parents' anniversary, so we the Mr. and Mrs. Swift went.
Yeah,
which was lovely. They had a great time. Thank you, Will.
That's okay. I'm glad they did. My favorite bit was when Mr. Swift sat down and pulled out a packet of lollies. I'm like, oh yeah. Oh yeah, they're related.
Did he actually? Did he really?
Like he brought from home.
Yeah.
No, what?
Possibly. Just, it was in the pocket.
What lollies?
Oh, just yeah.
What lollies? This is news to me.
They weren't red frogs. They weren't red frogs. Same brand, but they were a packet of snakes, which I quite liked. I like that there's a familiar closeness.
Allen's?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, but the Swifts are all unique in their sugar preferences.
Allen's
yeah.
changed yeah. their snakes to taste like the killer python flavors,
and
it was a massive W.
Oh, disagree.
Massive W for Allen's. Allen's, something... if you're interested in sponsor this side of the room. Killer Python me all day.
Starburst, you can sponsor. Wait, sorry, I'm hearing reports there's no more Starburst. Who's going to sponsor us?
They're gone.
Oh my God.
No sponsor for that side.
Have you not been enjoying the glorious Swedish candy we brought back
Absolutely.
For you?
Absolutely.
Oh, I love the Hukenladen. Yeah. And it's like chocolate.
Yeah.
Oh, the Skånkenjagen. And it's like a gummy. I love it.
But it's a Swedish gummy.
Yeah.
Oh, and Norwegian.
And it's not chocolate, it's chocolate.
Oh, chocolate.
Makes a difference. I like the in the bag. Some are in their own packaging and some aren't.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
They have no regard for the environment.
No.
Yeah, it is wild.
That's the same in Japan, actually. All of their sweets are individually packaged inside larger packages. It's like a whole thing.
I wonder if that's the unboxing thing, because they've got a lot of things that you just...
Oh, they just love unwrapping
stuff. Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I love the open shit. I love it. It feels so good.
They
do have
a significantly more robust garbage disposal setup over there, though. They have waste management. They have multiple recycling bins.
Mm.
This is Norway.
Norway.
Like just around?
Yeah, and they're like go
around,
to these...
but also at every house that we stayed at, because we stayed in some Airbnbs, there were four bins. There was like the glass and metal bin. There was plastics that are recyclable bin. There was an organics bin everywhere. So there was compost. And there was just the rest. It was literally the rest was like the other rubbish was just called all the other shit.
But then there were also like these like there were like bins out on the street that were like basically like a garbage chute that goes to an underground thing. And so you would put like your garbage in there and then it would go somewhere else.
See, that's crazy because in Sydney they just took away
it's like how was Norway? Let me tell you about the garbage.
They took away 3/4 of the bins in Sydney and went, just throw your dog shit bags into lime bikes.
Yeah.
You know? Fuck a bin. Who cares?
Far out. That's so funny.
That's why lime exists.
That's so funny.
You put the rubbish on that, and then you throw the lime bike in the river.
It's where they belong. Broken show we were watching where he just
yearns for the water.
He kicks the scooters all the time. And I found that the funniest thing about that whole show. A show with Rose Byrne and Seth Rogen that we were watching while we were away.
Oh, yeah.
And he just like it's
platonic.
It's a point that he just every time he sees one of those scooters, he just trashes it. He's like, that's what they're there for. And he just like throws them at walls and stuff like that and kicks them all over and kicks them onto the street.
And Steph, I was gonna ask you a little bit about what do you want to talk about from Norway? But we've talked about Norway now, so.
What else?
I feel like we've covered it.
It was awesome. I talked about it on I West Street last night, so I talked about it.
But I'll give you one fjord.
I feel like the takeaway was that it was just too spectacular for my brain to process. Like I had a bit of a like 404 moment where I just was like, like it just doesn't look real. I felt like I could touch it. The mountains were so tall but close. I don't know how else to say it. Like nothing should rise that steeply and be lit so majestically from the side. And it was.
You hear that? Barangaroo.
What?
So tall and lit so majestically.
Yeah. Nothing. Yeah.
Just beautiful buildings down there.
We had a good time. I got a little bit sick towards the end, but I was refusing to let it stop me from doing anything. Because I had planned this trip years ago and there was stuff that I'd been like wanting to do forever. So I was like, a cold? Not happening. So there were a few like hikes that I was going up the hill going, so beautiful.
I'll tell that one good moment then. We were on the steepest hike that we did on the trip. And it was
1,500
stairs or something. And it was
I sold it to Peter in a way that was like, it's going to be fine. And like...
It was not fine. but it was worth it and it was super moody and cool. But, you know, it was designed to like... You would stop along the way because no one was going to make it in one hit unless they're a super athlete. And
it's like it doesn't level out at all. It's literally just like stairs,
zigzagging
all the way
stairs,
up the mountain.
And like not the pyramids vertical, but very, very steep.
They
should just have a really steep ramp.
Yeah.
Right.
Accessibility.
Yeah, because it's like the stairs were tall as well. Yeah. So you were lifting your legs very high. It was a serious. It was a cardio burn, man. It was so intense.
But we were about halfway up, and there were like stone seats that had been put like just off the side so people could sit down. And there was a woman sitting down up there, and we were kind of like snaking our way back up around towards her, and we just stopped on the stairs and looking out on the majesty below, because we were already halfway up and it was already looking pretty specky. And then I was looking out, and I was aware that woman was up there, and then we just heard which was Steph blowing her nose. Oh. And and I looked back around and saw Steph holding a tissue, and the woman on the seat just was just dying of laughter. Because she got like a fright from the serenity being cut through with like the horns of Gondor. Like,
Listen, I have a very honky nose blow. You do. But I can't, I don't know how people don't. Like, I don't know how you blow your nose and not like blow it so hard that it makes a honk sound and feel like you've sufficiently because like when I get sick, I create so much mucus in my face. Like it's like it does not end for like a week. I feel like you get sick and you're like a little bit sniffly, but you kind of just go, I don't know what's going on with your nasal passages. They create wicked catastrophic sound every night when you sleep, but like no snot apparently, and maybe that's the key.
You clear them out.
But
I have just a
God.
Big nose, so I think there's still heaps of snot up there.
Like,
pick it out.
The sound that I have to put up with every night, but the two times a year, if that I get sick, I do not hear the end of like the nose blow sound that he has to deal with. Oh my God.
All I say is the horns of Gondor every time.
Life must be so hard. Picking
on you?
Yeah, what a great trip you guys had.
Yeah.
Bins and honking.
It was definitely like we had not seen each other for weeks. We've been so busy. And then suddenly we were with each other for like 24 hours a day for 3 weeks. Yeah. No
respite.
Darkness either. It was 24 hour sunlight as well. Yeah, and it was just like, I went a little bit mad, I think.
How do you sleep?
Well, you'd think you'd draw the curtains. They just don't have them. In a country where they're like, they have summers where there is no nighttime.
Yeah.
You'd think
they had like light filter things, but they didn't. There
they're
was
like
just light.
Bonkers.
Oh, just close eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, okay.
Some hotels were like, we can offer you like pleb tourists a sleeping mask if you need it. Wake.
Yeah. It really was like a
close eyes,
challenge.
Pussy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, oh, great. Cool.
So that's what we've all been up to. Josh did make amends with his family, though. He did hang out with them, so that was good.
And I missed it at the event, but I got given a bubbly.
Are you going to drink it on stream?
I guess I should. Famous for tasting liquids.
It's a bubbly.
No, I think it's
famous for tasting liquids.
Oh, they've just
liquids.
Capitalized on the marketing opportunity.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, cool.
But it's just sparkling water.
Does
no
it taste
sugar.
Like him?
I don't have the comparison.
Oh,
that's sad.
It smells pretty good.
You've been to so many concerts.
I thought that
and
was
not licked
included
once?
In the ticket.
That is the nut corner.
That's not bad.
Can I smell it?
Yeah, smell it. Got a bit more of a scent than most sparkling water.
What does that mean?
I don't know. Usually it's just kind of water with
nothing going
on.
What does
it
smell
like? Like a nice lime.
Limey. Yeah.
Oh, limey.
Limey, in a good way. Not like a limey bastard. I don't know. Is that offensive? I don't actually know the origin of that. Like, that's like,
did I just say a slur
then? Did I just maybe say a slur?
Wait, which?
Limey?
I don't think it is.
I've never heard that.
The palms would say it.
Yeah.
You limey bastard.
You limey bastard.
I thought it means like shifty.
Maybe you worked with lime in making like making like concrete?
Oh, like lime.
Cement?
So not
maybe working with lime, not limes.
Lime, yeah.
That could be it.
So referring to British people as limey. Originated as a derogatory term used to describe members of the Royal Navy who added lime juice to their daily rum because citrus helps sailors prevent scurvy.
Yeah, okay.
Wait, well, I think it was a dig on people who were trying to just not fucking
not get
die?
Scurvy. Just, yeah.
Yeah.
To be fair, the Navy is the worst.
Imagine that would have been like, oh, you poncy bastard putting a bit of lime in your water. And he's just like, all right, like,
you die.
When you fucking die, I'll be laughing on the other side of my face, dickhead.
It's time for a little bit of backup.
It's time for a little bit of backup, baby. Not too much, just a little bit. And this week, as always, it's brought to us by Evil Spy Boy. Check chat for exclamation mark Evil Spy Boy. And why not be just like Evil Spy Boy and bring some generosity of your own to Food Bank Australia, baby. Woo-woo! You can donate to Food Bank Australia at foodbank.org.au and help out just like Evil Spy Boy. And if you don't, you're a bad person and I'm going to judge you.
You don't want to be judged.
Yeah.
Yeah. Especially not by me. I'm vicious.
Yeah.
I'm a cold hard bitch, just like Jet said.
Remember Jet?
Oh, Jet.
That's cold hard bitch. Yeah. Every other song sounds the same.
love them. I saw them live.
Me too.
A big top at Luna Park.
Big day out. You started that sentence and I was like, big day? No.
And so this week, and a little bit of backup, McDonald's made a video game.
They sure
Why?
Did.
Grimpus birthday?
Grimpus birthday.
Oh, it's my goodness.
Grimace is turning 52 this Whoa. Year.
That's
that old,
old
bastard.
But like, they're not still used in current marketing.
Grimace.
Grimace
like
had a little
any
comeback,
of the characters that are part of the McDonald's universe.
No, they are.
Yeah, they haven't come back. Hamburglar was recently
really?
Brought back to
yeah.
They give them soft retirements and then bring them back.
Yeah.
52.
They all freaked me out as a
kid. But the,
you can get your pension.
People in suits and just like running around being creeps.
Yeah.
I once it was one of those like Ronald McDonald visits the facility kind of thing.
Mm.
You know, weird way to phrase that. But I saw him coming and hid under the table, and while I was under the table, the big fucking feet just flat there, and I'm like,
that's a horror movie.
That's like, underneath the table.
Like, that sounds like Five Nights at Freddy's bullshit.
Yeah, totally.
Like,
I like it.
Mm. But Grimace was always nice because he's just a big nugget.
Tell me about this.
I only recently found out that he was a nugget.
So you may notice.
I just really need to clarify. This is not sponsored.
No.
This is just dumb reality. please tell us about Grimace the purple nugget.
Yeah, he's a nugget, and I think he was originally so I had a moment of weakness. My brain was not well, and I decided to read up on as much McDonald's lore as I
Sick.
Possibly
amazing.
Could
amazing.
I did this on an hour-long drive where I was not driving, but can you imagine if I was? And I decided to read all about McDonald's, and Grimace was originally introduced as a bad guy. I think who would like steal everyone's nuggets?
So not the Hamburglar.
You are
no,
what you
not
eat.
The Hamburglar. He was also like Grimace
was
a bad guy. And then they were
the
like, actually, why don't we just make Grimace a nice man?
Yeah,
just
good.
A nice man. And so they did. And now Grimace was a good guy. And yeah, he was a big nugget.
I feel like that's a retcon. I feel like that he was just an amorphous blob. And then later on, they were like, shit, what is Grimace? And they were like, let's make him a nugget. And so he'd be like, but he's purple. And people would be like, whatever, we're McDonald's. If we say he's a nugget, he's a nugget.
Purple nugget.
And then we'll bring out a purple nugget and everyone will go nuts for it. Fucking marketing.
Like if they say chicken nuggets are chicken and everyone's like, sure.
And then they milked
him.
Legally now they have
right.
to.
And then they milked him and made the Grimace shake.
I want to point out that Josh is playing right now. So if
you're also trying to run the show.
You can't do eight things at once? Come on.
The Grimace game is very, very cool. It is... It was made on this like GeoCities-like web page that
it.
I am so deeply obsessed with. And you know, you're skating Grimace. You're skating to your birthday party, I'm fairly certain.
You gotta collect the other members of the rogues gallery of
Grimace
McDonald's.
Gang.
Right? Don't you have to you gotta
on
find
Grimace's
Ronald and...
birthday, they're called the Grimace Gang. I
okay.
don't know if that's canon, but I'm just saying it
it's
out
not
loud
on Wikipedia.
And making it canon.
So
Josh.
So that like it, you know this
oh, wait,
is
Josh is playing this
yeah.
live.
Yeah. He's also he's also editing.
Just
why
stay on
is 50 so bad?
Yeah.
Like, he says get I mean, just stay on the white and get good.
Just stay on the
white. Cancel the rest of the show. No. This is it.
Listen.
Free skate.
No. I put it on hard mode because I'm a fucking try hard. So if I put it on, this will be easier.
I mean, he says that.
Oh, yeah, because on hard mode, on easy mode, well, normal mode, you grind on rails automatically.
Right.
But on hard mode, I think you have to press a button to do it.
It's messed up. Oh, that's too hard.
Grimace can't multitask.
Yeah.
No.
He's a big nugget.
He just doesn't have like enough of like a leg spread to be able to like negotiate the skateboard well. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's got a like natural drop crotch.
He's been posting on the McDonald's Twitter account, and my housemate made a really good point that he
Grimace or the guy that made the game?
my housemate / bestie / wife.
Okay.
She made a really good point that Grimace was tweeting like a valley girl. Shouts out Phoebe. He was like, oh, I've got a surprise, blah blah blah, and I saw someone he posted Grimace's phone number. Grimace posted his phone number, and you could text Grimace.
Dox himself.
And someone quote tweeted that tweet, being like, "Grimace just sent me this," and it was. it was a Grimace dick pic.
Yeah.
And I was like, "Oh, that's what it looks
purple
like."
Purple slugs.
That's crazy.
It was just like a corner of him.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. He is all.
He's the kind of the same.
He's
all
the
over.
Same shape everywhere. Yeah.
So
this, yeah, this is a promotional thing, and it's doing what Mac has wanted to do, which you have to talk about McDonald's. But the reason people aren't giving any kind of crap is that it's actually a well-built game, and one of the surprising things was, so McDonald's were like, this is on a browser, but it's also on Android and iOS, and the surprise was that the developer made it a ROM compatible with Game Boy Color emulation. So it is built to
be
a Game Boy Color game and then distributed on mobile and on web. But they also were like, you know, I'm just going to sneak this one out onto emulation if you want to play it on an emulator.
That's so good.
Yeah, and so someone said people put it on a cartridge and it worked. Dolphin Pets saying that. And someone was playing it on the...
My friend George, shouts out, played it on the Analog Pocket.
Yeah, amazing.
And it looks amazing.
Like, yeah.
It looks perfect. Like, it rocks.
Amazing. He's so cute.
That's so cute.
I love him.
We went to Macca's when we were in Norway.
Mm. It's spicy nuggets.
It was exciting because they had so many much truffle on the menu. It was like fucking truffle burgers everywhere.
What?
Yeah, there was a lot of truffle.
Yeah.
Yum.
Crazy. And caramelized onion and stuff.
They're a wealthy nation.
Nuts. But like, I was like looking at the menu and like, well, look at all the things that are different. Peter's like, are you going to make a decision?
Rude. Let her cook.
This is one of many couple stories that I have to sprinkle in throughout the night of our time in Norway together.
It was taking an exceedingly long time to decide about a
McDonald's
burger.
I know, but it's like I like to find the joy in the small moments of being in another country.
Also, when you're at a different country's McDonald's, that is such a magical and special experience. I was at a Singapore, the McDonald's at Singapore airport, and it changed my life.
Yeah. Japan, it's nuts.
Oh my God.
They have like, they had the charcoal buns over there, and they had like little nori things happening.
So you just get it.
Yeah.
You don't, why are you making the decision? You're not going to get a Big Mac. You're going to get the weird thing.
No, but you got to look at all the different things and marvel at the differences.
There's only two different things.
We didn't have anywhere to be that day. We were just fucking driving.
We had hours of continent to cross.
You were there for weeks. Let her cook.
Let's get on with the actual show. It's Key 3 Trail Fest.
Welcome to Key 3.
Oh man, Will Arnett, man, he's aged so 1,000 years. I feel like I know that jet lag. I've seen that jet lag on myself yesterday.
Key 3 and his amazing friends. Amazing
Absolutely.
Friends.
Yeah, amazing friends.
Is brought to us in part by Buri Buri. Buri Buri, our favorite lawyer who would have been all across the IP across the last week. For Buri Buri, we of course read out a, you would have experienced this before, Ruby, a strange law/legal kind of tidbit.
I thought you meant the law itself.
Not the law.
Like, well, no, maybe. You got me.
This
had a few brushes.
If we were in the right location, and we are not, would apply to us tonight. Let me read. In Florida, it is illegal to fart in a public place after 6 p.m. on Thursdays.
I call bullshit. I mean, I call bullshit on all of these, but that's so specific.
I want to do that just to be sent to jail for farting.
Yeah.
That would rock.
Yeah.
Why so what are you in here for? You'll never guess.
And instead of a little tear tattoo, you get a little like fart cloud.
Yeah, the little fart cloud. Yeah. Oh.
And that's like, what are you gonna put someone in jail for farting?
Mm.
Oh, and that's a really good point. Taco Thursdays?
Isn't Taco Tuesdays?
It's Tuesdays.
It's Taco Day can be any day that's a T, I think, actually.
It's only two.
It's just
days.
That it's like it's a thirst sound, not a ter sound. So it's
yeah,
kinda
it's
like
Taco Tuesdays.
Is it not pronounced
no.
Thursday?
Thursday.
Thursday.
Named after Thor because it's Thor's day.
Oh.
And Thor never farts.
Nope.
He is a prince.
No, he just never farts after 6 p.m. Yeah. He gets all his farts out in the daytime.
Oh, well, we worked it out. It all makes sense.
Makes sense.
So Keith Reed's been raging the last week. And all the big players are kind of been in and around it. PlayStation were a few weeks back. They jumped the gun as they want to do, don't they? They tend to do.
Mm.
They're like their own player, aren't they?
Yeah, I feel like
they're like the rich kid with like the gold soccer ball, and no other kid in the neighborhood's allowed to play with them or their ball.
I feel like there's exactly what I was thinking. There was a thing that started happening with E3 where it was like this battle of like Xbox and PlayStation and who was going to win E3. And just by like not participating in it, they kind of removed themselves from that competition and the ability to be compared.
Mm.
It was actually quite clever.
Yeah. It's actually crazy because PlayStation event has those words have the same two first letters as premature ejaculation, which one would say is like a very similar case because they came before everybody else did.
Mm. They did. But was everyone satisfied? Will, talk us through the PlayStation.
Oh, through PlayStation, yeah, okay. I can do that one. Yeah, handballer to me for sure. We don't want to just sit. You want to sit with that for a second?
Welcome back, Frosty Phoenix.
Yeah.
It's so good to have you back.
Welcome back to Back Pocket. PlayStation kicked off with Fair Games, which was Fair Games spelled with a
dollar sign
at the end of
Fair
it.
Fair Game Money.
Yep. Fair Game Money, which is the trailer I just assumed it was going to be Payday, because it's a very Payday feeling trailer. It's a very Payday looking game, and it's coming to us from Jade Raymond's new studio, Haven, which she worked on Assassin's Creed and Watch Dogs. So it's like the identity is within this thing.
Yeah.
But
It's the first game from Haven Studios since they were acquired by PlayStation as well.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see. I mean, obviously we've got Xbox, we'll talk about later, but have a bunch of first-party games kind of starting to release because they've spent the last few years acquiring studios. Mm. PlayStation have really only spent the last 12 months doing the same thing, starting to pick at the really successful studios that have create a games for PlayStation, and they're like, we want some exclusivity.
Is it like one of those things where it's like those deals may have been in process or whatever for a long periods of time?
Absolutely. But yeah, the fruits of kind of that are going to start to come more and more frequently for PlayStation.
Yep.
And I should point out as well, we're not going to talk in depth about every single game because there were hundreds of trailers over the last week. But we will stop on things that we think are interesting.
Yes. Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
I don't know, particularly interesting, but Helldivers 2 kind of looked like Starship Troopers.
Which is a very good version of that thing that crashed the other week for you guys.
It might be a more functional online experience.
Yeah.
It looks quite interesting. Immortals Avenum?
Avium?
Avium? I don't care about that.
Thank you.
Before I said if I don't care about a game, I'm going to openly say it out really loud.
It's important.
I feel like there's a lot of like Bioshocky stuff that's kind of around at the moment that's emulating a lot of stuff that we've seen before and feels very like this is like so 5 years ago but looks beautiful.
I think what got me about Immortals was like the screen was so busy. And it freaked me out. Mm. There was too much going on.
Yeah.
I could see too much of my hands.
And to me, but I will say this about it, and I won't say much about it, but it looks like Obsidian's game Avowed. They look so similar. In that they're like first-person magic games. And
but like your hands work like guns.
Yeah, and I think Immortals, from what I've seen of it, looks nicer. But I know Obsidian deliver RPGs, so remains to be seen who's going to come out on top on that.
Yep.
Yeah.
Ghost Runner 2 was one of my games of the year for like 2020, so I'm very excited that that got a sequel.
Yeah.
Cyberpunky, fast runny, all that kind of thing. The big thing is that there's a bike in it now. That's kind of it. Yeah. When I was watching it, I'm like, oh yeah. And then he just gets on a bike. I'm like, sick.
That's what that game needed. More speed.
More speed. He wasn't going fast enough. Now he's on a bike.
I appreciated Keanu's appearance being like.
Well, that was Cyberpunk.
Oh, sorry.
Also,
what is this?
This is Ghost Runner.
Yeah.
Remember the like samurai slow motion, fast dash wall running? Yeah. It was like a time trial.
Yeah, but it was a very pretty game, so I'm keen for more of it.
Yep.
I think it's later this year, which is cool. Flip Phantom Blade Zero, which is a funny name.
Yep.
What was it? Sword of the Sea, which is very exciting. That's from the Abzu Pathless devs. I adore the Pathless and Abzu, and this looks like it's combining the two. So
yeah.
And remind me, how many days does this guy have to live? I seem to forget how many days this guy has to live. I think he mentioned it a few times how many days this guy has to live. I think it was like 90 days, not 60 days to live. Anybody remember this? I remember watching this and thinking, I wonder how many days this guy has to live.
In Phantom Blade?
In Phantom Blade Zero, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't remember.
But I assume it's mentioned multiple times.
It's mentioned multiple times.
Totally breezed over. Yeah. Talos Principle.
Talos Principle is a game.
Yep.
Never from the Grist devs.
Yep.
Which is cool.
They're attached to four-letter titles, apparently.
Yes, and pretty games. Which is very cool.
This is this made me sad. This trailer made me sad.
Mm.
The big foxy thing.
That's a sign of a good game.
Wolfy thing.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
Let it live. Let it live.
Let it live.
I don't want it to freaking die.
Why do things die all the time?
Let it die. Yeah. Look at it go.
Because it's the easiest way to elicit an emotional response.
Look at that. Yeah, we'll talk about that later in a different segment. we've got Cat Quest, Pirates of the Caribbean, which is very good.
That's a funny name.
It's a very funny name. I think there's a few cat games. I think that's cat games and fox games are the big things.
I was not expecting to see a Cat Quest game in the PlayStation Showcase. Happy about it. It
Pirates
rocks.
Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, really good.
It's very good. Very pretty. Yeah, there's a few games in this that almost felt like a Nintendo Direct. Like there was some cool, like kind of poppy indies.
Yeah.
fucking Foam Stars.
That's pretty fucking. That's pretty
As I wrote in the script, yuck.
Yeah.
Don't like it. Don't like the name.
Yeah.
It doesn't look very interesting. It's just
Splatoon.
It's Splatoon.
Yeah.
Plucky Squire, which we've known about for a while, but I think all excited for.
So excited for this.
Want it to be great and review terribly.
That's right.
Done it by Australian devs as well.
Yeah.
Because wreck those points Gus's. It's in Gus's.
Oh, I see. I was why would you want? Got it.
Pick your favorite.
Great art.
Rate games on the website. Make them. Teardown. I'm very excited for coming to console because.
Yeah.
I mean, I've got a PC that works. Now, but for a while I wanted to play Teardown. It's a nice way to play it now with hopefully very functional. That was Teardown. I was like, what's that?
Yeah, this is Teardown. Yeah.
Metal Gear Solid Delta Snake Eater was probably the biggest thing.
That definitely got the most attention online.
Yeah.
Still in dream.
It is a fancy pants remake of 3. Mm-hmm. I've never played 3. Titled Snake Eater.
Snake Eater.
Is that correct?
Snake Eater.
It was Metal Gear Solid 3 Snake Eater.
Yes.
Yeah.
They dropped the 3.
Yes. They went to Delta.
Yes.
The third letter in the Greek alphabet.
Triangle.
And there's a triangle.
Yeah.
Okay.
And it's home.
It's triangle because there's three sides. It's not right.
I mean, that's correct.
They were like, it's Delta because it started new or some shit like that. And I was like, I can't read.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. People True Heart 78 points out in chat. This is Sans Kojima.
Mm.
I am going to be a little bit controversial, and I think that's a good thing. I think Kojima is a bit of an auteur, but he's also a shitty editor.
I think he gets in his own way a bit.
Yep. Yeah. And he has created the brilliant thing in Metal Gear Solid 3, and letting another team handle a remake, I think, is the best of both worlds. It's going to be edited to be something more enjoyable, in my opinion, than Kojima laboring on things. Mm-hmm. I love the gag of the ladder, right? Like, I get some things get drawn out as a bit, and that's cool. Mm-hmm. But my God, he just doesn't know how to tell a succinct story and without just repetition. Mm. So I hope that this is modernized and still obviously has Kojima's creativity behind it, but is a clean version.
Like, made by fans as well. Like, I'm sure
most
people in the industry making games have probably played and enjoyed. Yeah, so they'll know what to keep.
It's an homage to the parts of the game that they love the most.
Totally. Honestly, I'd much prefer them remaking a Kojima-made game than trying to make a new one without him involved.
Yeah.
Like Metal Gear Solid specifically, just because, like, I mean, yeah, Metal Gear Survive? So, like, I think it's, better.
They're not re-recording the audio. Yeah, totally. Mm.
So the story will be the same, but they can cut heaps of it.
And they can get rid of it.
You know?
Make it faster. Towers of Agabash?
I think it's Ahagio.
Ah.
Ahageo?
Oh. Agaspa. Agaspa.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Oh, Gus isn't here to do the
I'm the only one who can't read.
Gus's face.
And yet I can say it.
Have you seen Gus's...
He says things wrong?
No, he does have the huggy-o.
Oh, no, not with your hager.
That's the one he does.
Yeah, a hegel face.
Yeah, he does that.
He does it really well. Yeah.
And quick.
Astonishingly well.
Okay, but
really
when you say...
And like he knows it, and so he's like, fine, I'll do it. And then he does it, and he's like, oh, whoa.
He is amazing at it.
Yeah. And Josh doesn't even push the zoom button. It just happens.
Yeah.
Like it just
the camera like
the
just
camera
gets
is drawn into the face.
Magnetized.
It's nice to know that Gus is secretly an anime girl.
Mm-hmm.
It's heartwarming actually.
Yeah.
We also got Final Fantasy 16 news.
Yeah.
Can we pause for a moment?
Yes, we can.
Because I played the demo last night?
Night
before?
It was last night.
What
day? It was last night. Today's Thursday.
I played it last night. I was on stream. I was live last night. I played it. Oh my gosh. Okay. So let me just get this out of the way.
Chaos.
Because I feel like my experiences with Final Fantasy have been like reviewing them for Good Game, and I didn't grow up with them. So I've kind of never really sort of synced with JRPGs. But in playing Final Fantasy 14 and kind of getting to know the game alongside a community of people who really love it, it's become like a huge part of my life. So now I'm kind of like entering this game with a different lens, but also I still am such a traditional fantasy nerd. This kind of caters to everything that I'm specifically going to love in Final Fantasy.
Yeah.
So playing through the demo, I was super excited. We are introduced to the protagonist, who is the best kind of Final Fantasy character, I think, an emo
What's
prince.
His name?
So he's introduced as Wyvern, which is like the coolest fucking name you have ever heard in your life. I was like, man, I thought I had like my potential baby names picked out for the child that I will never have. Merlin and Jasper, great names, would never have happened. But when I heard Wyvern, I was like, that's such a fucking cool name.
Cool
oh my
name.
God.
Hey, Lizard Boy.
Turns out Wyvern is his last name.
Yeah, what's his first name?
And I see someone running towards him going, Clive.
Oh, wow.
Clive.
Clive Wyvern.
Clive.
Wyvern.
And he's like, he's so that beautiful. Sucks. Everyone in this game is so fucking beautiful with the most amazing hair and stunning features. Everyone is just like peak Euro perfectionism.
Clive.
And his name is Clive. And he is accompanied by Rodney.
Oh my God.
Tyler.
Tyler's so bad.
Wow.
And Jill.
Are these American voice artists as
no,
well?
No, no. It is as British can be. Like,
that's
it is
sick.
So.
Oh, but like,
show
David
me.
Chronicles like.
Yeah.
Like a little anime girl going, hello.
And there's a Wade
there's
as well.
There's a bit of that. There's Wade. Yeah. It's just, it's so funny.
Names have got me into this game.
Oh,
yeah, that's funny as hell.
Rodney.
But show me a single
Rodney.
British person with the name Tyler.
Mm.
That's only
that's
in California.
There's such specific choices. Mm. But it's like, It's Clawing altogether like one of the most epic intros to a game that I've played in a long time. I would say in terms of its fantasy style, it's kind of Game of Thronesy in its aesthetic, and it's kind of like it's got a bit of a dark sort of conniving royal family kind of plot line.
Yeah.
The magic and sort of mysterious magic element is really cool and interesting, and sets itself up in a really spectacular kind of cliffhangery ending of the demo that I played, which is about 2 hours. It controls really beautifully. It just looks stunning. And the voice cast is, for how hilarious their names are, excellent.
Yeah, cool.
I cannot find the name of Rodney's actor, whoever played the protagonist's dad. Mm. He sounds so much like Sean Bean. much like Sean Bean. It could be Sean Bean, but I'm not sure.
The character dies.
Sean Bean, I might be wrong. Presumably. I might be lying. I might be telling a fib.
Yeah.
But there was a Final Fantasy movie, Kingsglaive, and Sean Bean was in that.
He's just, this character doesn't have a northern accent, and I'm pretty sure that he doesn't do a great job of getting rid of his accent.
Mm-hmm. No.
But it was spectacular. it was exciting. It was it's a single player like fantasy RPG that I feel like I've been waiting for, and I think it's because it's not so overwhelming in the way that a lot of open world fantasy RPGs are that I've traditionally liked. This is really presenting itself in a way that is like, I don't know, I'm very excited. But it's also got a lot of Final Fantasy elements that I'm starting to recognize without really needing, you don't need to have any Final Fantasy knowledge to enjoy this. You can just play it as a traditional fantasy RPG as a first time entrant into the Final Fantasy universe and not need any of that stuff. So
yeah, great.
I'm super, it's coming out next week.
Yeah. 22nd of June.
Clive.
Also, Alan Wake 2 was a pretty exciting one for the Alan Wake 2 is interesting because I have so many friends that have messaged me that like grew up gaming and don't play games anymore, and they're like, they're making another one? And I'm like, yeah. So there you go.
That is like perfect timing for your age.
Yeah.
The original Alan Wake was what, 2010?
Yeah.
So it's like your end of high school.
Yeah. I'm going to get an adult game.
Yeah. You're going to play the adult game, and then you're going to go and leave school and start a real life and be like, oh shit, I don't have time or money for games anymore.
Yeah.
So it's like the last game you ever played was Alan Wake.
Yeah, and then the sequel's coming.
Yeah.
These devs are saying that this is going to be like the best looking game that we play. This release window, at least, which is like
big call,
such a
big
baller call. Move.
Yeah. Particularly since we've like, seen it and it looks good, but it looks like everything else.
Yeah,
It looks pretty good. I think it looks well lit, which is important for an Alan Wake game.
It looks dark, and that's sick.
Yeah. I think it's so brave of, like, not just devs, but like anybody to be like before a game comes out, being like, this is the best game you are ever going to play. Because what if it's not? And like, not even like, what if it's bad, but like, what if it's not the best game you've ever played? Then that would be a lie.
It's also like,
and you could get sued for that.
You'd be so siloed.
You can't tell lies on the internet.
You'd be so siloed in your kind of own dev bubble, and you'd be like, so like into what you were making, and you would get little peeks at what other people were working on. But like, I can totally see how you'd be like, man, no one has made shit like this. And then you would get to like one of these events and everyone would like debut their games and you'd be like, oh shit.
Oh, everyone's made something like this. But it looks scary. It looks scary as hell.
Yeah, it looks super dark.
Is that Sean Bean?
And it's sitting in the October window. It's 17th of October. That month is very full.
Yes.
And that's the spooky month.
That's true.
It's a spooky month.
Yeah,
We also got a bit more of Assassin's Creed, but we'll talk about that a bit later. Revenant Hill was another cat game.
It's made by the two of the original devs from Night of the Woods.
Like Night of the Woods.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
I assume it was the artist and the animator of Night of the Woods are on
something
this game.
Something like that. But it looks beautiful.
They're involved.
Gorgeous.
We also got Granblue Fantasy Relink, which is an action RPG from the Granblue universe.
Yeah, I'm heavily invested in the Granblue universe.
Are you heavily invested in the Granblue?
When it came out, did you go for Granblue or Grand Red?
No, I've always been in the Granblue party. And this kind of goes back to my childhood.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if you guys are aware, Granblue is a portmanteau of grandfather and blowing a load.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so when my gran blew...
So that's why PlayStation did it.
Oh, my God.
It created my father.
Yeah.
And then
when my dad blew, it made me. Mm. So gran blew, dad blew. Who knows what could happen next? Yeah.
Street Fighter 6.
Don't clap for that. I think it's good.
God damn it.
I think it's good. I think I like it.
Don't encourage him.
I think it was long-winded and awful. Yeah. And I loved it.
It's awful. Street Fighter 6?
Street Fighter 6. Stallions.
Jesus, Peter.
Just laugh.
This is out very soon, so there was very little to be excited for. But if you're excited for the game.
What is this?
Street Fighter 6.
Street Fighter.
What is this?
This was the trailer, which was like, what would it look like if you were in Street Fighter 6?
Yeah, you would.
Yeah, this came out on the 2nd of June. It was out soon when this came
Wait,
out.
Wait, it's out now. True.
Yes. But it is out now, yeah.
It's already out.
Yeah, Street Fighter's out. People are fucking loving this.
Yeah, right.
And...
Is this the one that took like a bit of a different direction and has got like
open world?
It looks amazing. Yeah.
It's got a we were away, so I haven't looked too heavily into it because I'm not a massive Street Fighter guy. But it looks like the campaign has like choices and a little bit of like dating sim to it that people are really enjoying. And the other big thing I've seen is that E Honda. Is actually really, really viable this game, which is sick because is a staple of the series, but never really a top tier character. So people are playing him a lot, and that's cool.
That is cool. I feel like that this is the kind of thing that would get me to pick up a Street Fighter game after all these years because I feel like, you know, if you're not like a hardcore fighter person, this is a genre of game that I just tend to not touch. But if they're creating more to it, that excites me. I don't know if it'll work well or not, but I'm interested. Yeah.
I just think it looks so good. I think the art style is incredible.
And it looks like it's not taking itself too seriously, which I'm not saying Street Fighter necessarily has in the past. Like, you beat up a car as a bonus round, but like it feels like it's extrapolated on that in a really kind of quirky, fun way.
We also got Ultros, which is... a nice looking little indie game.
Gooey game. Gooey game. It's kind of stinky, it's like, slimy. It's kind of like a squelchy.
Squelchy Dead Souls game. Is what my...
I'm getting acid trip from it.
Yeah.
It's giving like
wet acid.
Yeah.
That's what that looks like. Tower of Fantasy, which is a game. It was kind of looked very gamey.
It's perfect.
But the big, there you go.
A game that looked very gamey.
It's Genshin, Impact, but it's also Honkai Star Rail.
Yeah.
And that's my opinion.
I was watching this trailer earlier today and I said, this looks shit. And then Ruby arced the fuck up.
Yeah.
I said, shut the hell up. Yeah. Shut your freaking mouth, shut up. That's what I said.
Yeah. Then we did get to see a little bit of Dragon's Dogma 2.
Yes!
Which is still living in the TBC realm, but we'll find out more soon, I'm sure.
I'm very excited about this. I fucking love Dragon's Dogma. Mm-hmm. It came out of nowhere, and it was like... It refreshed, like, open-world fantasy in such a cool way by giving you that, like, Shadow of the Colossus kind of ability to climb different monsters. But it also had that thing of, like, when the sun set... everything became like a whole lot more terrifying. And I'm really excited to kind of, because I feel like the problem with it was also, it was a cool concept, but the environmentally it was very bland. Mm-hmm. And so then as time went on and I wanted to kind of go back and revisit it, I always kind of looked at it and was like, ugh, it just does not hold up over time. So I'm excited to see it, you know, look better, hopefully more. It still looks a little bit bland in the background, you draw distancey kind of areas, but hopefully the sort of close-up detail and gameplay will be enough to carry through.
Yeah.
Very excited.
It's such a technical marvel.
Can I help you, Arisen?
I the only other thing I'll say about it is that I saw a video of Alana Pierce kind of doing some coverage, and she was talking about how much Capcom are kicking ass right now. They got Dragon's Dogma 2 coming on the pipeline. They've got Street Fighter 6 has just come out and people are going mad. And they're just kicking goals across their whole slate. And they're still doing weird shit like that Exo Primal game that will probably be awful. But the fact that they're
I thought you were going to say awesome.
No.
I was like, I know, right?
The fact that they're still Resident Evil, like, and they're kicking goals with Resident Evil. And they just kind of like... still trying stuff. Yeah. You know? They're not just like trying to bunker down and go like, oh, this worked. We can only do this because this is what works.
Yeah.
They're splashing cash on dumb stuff.
Yeah.
Love
to
see
That's the best way to live.
Love to see it.
Taking risks and having a good time.
Yeah.
You can splash cash on dumb stuff like VR, Pete.
You can splash dumb.
There was a couple of games. Nothing really huge in this lineup. It just felt like, hey, we put out the PSVR 2. Here's
there
some
are things.
Things
coming.
There's a sequel to Five Nights at Freddy, Help
one
Wanted.
You can kiss Freddy on the lips.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Is that the new accessory there?
Yeah, you spend only five nights
with
Freddy.
It's the lips accessory. Where you can kiss Freddy Fazbear on the lips.
Wow.
And he will say, you're such a good kisser. And that's when you can say, and the only line you can say back is, I know I am Freddy Fazbear. And that's the whole game.
Yeah. And it's the horror of this one is that it all ends after five nights and you part ways. You don't get to, it's so sad.
Because the thing is that that's the first night, and then the other four nights are him avoiding you because it was really awkward, and now he doesn't want to see you anymore.
Amazing.
In fact, you're trying to find Freddy. He's not trying to find you. You want to kiss again.
Resident Evil 4,
Resident Evil,
VR, Arizona Sunshine 2, another sequel to some VR, which is very exciting. Crossfire Sierra Squad, which is cool. They're like hammering home that IP that they've finally gotten out of Japan.
Fuck, that game sounds actually incredible.
Oh dear.
And co-op. VR co-op is cool.
I think the only other VR co-op game I've encountered was like the Ghostbusters. Mm. And I'm like, that's cool. So that's a cool one to have. And also Synapse, which they've been showing a lot of in all of these things and always looks really poppy and cool.
Yeah.
But the big ones are two from Bungie, which was Marathon, which is bringing back the 90s IP, as well as the new Destiny 2, The Final Shape.
Yeah.
I can't believe you had to check your screen for that. The Final Shape is like all I wasn't talking about in Destiny for so long. What is The Final Shape? Theories are it's friendship.
Yeah. Right. Like, actually.
I don't know. It's going to be something like that. It's going to be like the universe comes together and the final shape is like unity or something like that.
Or a circle.
Sorry. That's the last shape. A lot of triangles in Destiny also. I feel like I just don't want to see anything to do with this. My biggest issue with Destiny right now is that they just show so much of the stuff before the stuff comes out. And then it's like, I've seen all of it.
This trailer
like,
was a massive spoiler.
Don't show me any of it.
Yeah,
such a weird choice to have this. Sorry, anyone that hasn't already seen it.
It's like those movie trailers that have the entire movie and
the whole plot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ballsy
plot. Wild.
But we'll find out more about the Destiny expansion on the 22nd of August. So that's exciting. Concord was a PvP multiplayer first-person shooter. I don't remember what this one.
It's also the first game made by, was it Firewalk Studios? Right, since they were acquired by PlayStation as well.
Yep.
It's a PvP.
That's
FBS.
Right, this one. Yeah, very pretty. I thought it was a No Man's Sky update for a second. But.
What I don't know.
Firewalk sounds familiar.
Mm.
You might be thinking Firewalk with Me, which is the Twin Peaks movie.
Possibly.
Great film. Great film. Great cinema. Whoop, whoop.
They made a jiggly burger. Don't know if that's it.
That was it. That was a burger and it was jiggling.
There you go.
Mm. That looks like a brioche bun.
Brioche bun.
Great.
Too sweet.
Sorry.
Let's get out of here. PS5, they also had two accessories in the AirPods, basically, which is cool. They also work on PC, which is a good thing.
Yeah, nice.
It's nice to be able to have that on across tech. The big thing was this, which is a tablet with a controller on either side.
It is not a handheld, and I'm tired of people saying that it is.
It's just like a backbone or whatever those things, right? Like you,
it's kind of. It's
but it
with
comes
a screen.
With a screen.
With a screen.
So it's
oh,
like,
it comes with it. But is the screen removable?
No. So
So you know how sometimes do you ever have a Wii U?
Yeah.
So you know how sometimes you can take the game off of the TV and just play it on the Wii U so then somebody else can watch a movie.
It's basically running on the main system.
It's just networked.
But the thing is Australia doesn't have PlayStation Now, which is, the cloud streaming.
Is it not network stream at all? Like, I assumed you would be able to at least... and again, we were away, so I didn't really watch it, but that you would be able to stream from your console directly
like,
to th- over
like
your home
remote
network.
Play. Yeah, yeah. Remote the mobile yeah, kind yeah, of thing. Cool. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Wi-Fi. But is yeah. To call it a handheld, I think, would be...
That's a good point, though.
Misleading.
If it played into PS Now...
That implies that you could just take it anywhere with a game on it.
Yeah,
that'd
be awesome.
Yeah, but it's got no brain.
It's got no brain.
It's got no brain.
It's all looks.
It's not a Vita.
It's not a Vita.
It's a Wii U gamepad.
And we also finally got a look at Spider-Man 2, which comes out this year. This is the first look at it, finally. And it comes out 20th. I was watching this live, and I was so pissed. I was like, what's this?
This isn't Spider-Man.
And it's, in fact, it is. This is a little bit, this isn't Kraven, but Kraven pops in. Got to look at the one of the
what's
many villains.
What's he
smelling
there?
Who's he?
What was he smelling then?
Sap.
Yeah, he's looking for prey.
Can you eat it?
Okay.
Sap?
Yeah. I think it depends on the sap.
It looks yummy.
Canadians do it all the fucking time.
They put it in the pancakes.
Is that what maple syrup is? Is it sap?
Straight from the tree.
Mm. Oh.
They boil it and shit.
Yeah, because it comes out like water.
Yeah.
It's surprising seeing tree sap.
Have
come
you seen
out.
Those videos of trees exploding?
But rubber is also tree sap, I think, so I wouldn't eat that one,
Whoa. We've been derailing so hard.
We're never getting through this list.
Shit.
If you skip halfway through this, Josh, we got to see a bit of gameplay, which was cool. This is Spidey. I think this is Miles Morales at this point, but it is switchable between the two Spider-Men. They're both in the game, which is very cool. I'm intrigued to know. I still don't see anything particularly new. And I'm currently playing through Miles on PC due to a film that came out. I was like, I need to get back into this.
Yeah.
And seeing that next to this, it's very pretty. It looks like they've gotten everything they've done on the PC ports onto a console, which is sick. But in terms of gameplay, I fear that it may be similar to God of War Ragnarok, where halfway through I'm I might just watch the rest. Hmm?
Spider-Man's more fun to play than God of War.
Peter!
God of War may be better as a piece of art.
Yep.
But Spider-Man was more fun from start to finish.
Yep.
I don't fucking care if it's the same game.
Yeah, yeah.
And all I needed to see in this was some new environments.
Yep.
And when I saw the neighborhood, I was like, fuck yeah.
Yeah, totally.
That's sick.
And I'm excited to know the mechanic of traversing that.
Yeah.
Small buildings.
Yeah, low. Yeah, you just kind of grab them. You just fly around.
And Venom is in this?
Venom's the other, the two villains we have so far are Venom and Kraven. There'll probably be a third to kind of, as the other game kind of just pulled upon so much.
Sure, yeah.
But that's Spidey as the Venom. They kind of, they show a little bit and then push through 6 months later. So I think this is a bit of a vertical slice, a good way.
So it's like Spider-Man 3.
Kind of, yeah. The best one.
The best one, arguably. <Sorry. laughs>
We'll see. But it's exciting. And then later on at Summer Games Fest, we found out it's coming out 20th of October and pre-orders and stuff happen tomorrow. But don't pre-order games.
They do not run out.
Literally, one of the big announcements out of this is that games are going to start being only digital.
In
fact, there's no reason to ever pre-order a game.
There's been more instances of people who've pre-ordered games getting them late.
Yeah.
If they've pre-ordered a collector's edition or something and it just doesn't get shipped or whatever.
You don't get to play the game.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just buy it. Or
so that was
do
3 weeks ago. That was PlayStation.
Yeah.
There's heaps more in that came from Summer Games Fest and a bunch of other stuff. I reckon we're going to have to power through a bit quicker.
Yep.
But
no more bits.
We can totally do bits. We'll do bits.
Occasional bits.
There's no slowing us down.
Just say a joke really quickly.
But because we've said that, we'll move
top
quicker.
Top line,
Prince of Persia, The Lost Crown made its first appearance at Summer Games Fest and then appeared again at Ubisoft. That's a thumbs up all around, I think. Sick.
Absolutely.
Sick. Give me Prince of Persia classic.
Rayman Legends is should be applied to so many games. So many IPs. The idea of that side-scrolly presentation is just perfect. So,
totally.
Yeah.
Mortal Kombat 1, why'd they put a 1 on it?
Because it's the brand new IP from this indie developer. Mm-hmm. It's the first Mortal Kombat game ever made. There's never been one before.
It's like when Xbox were like, we want it to be the one console, the one entertainment unit.
This is the one Mortal Kombat game. Mm. It's out September 19th.
Mm.
So it's out very soon. it'll be on top of us before we know it.
Yeah.
And I think that's a good amount of separation between Street Fighter and Mortal Kombat. So there's a bit of breathing room there.
But cool to have in the same year as well.
Yeah.
Good bit of competition.
Totally. Path of Exile 2 was a surprise. It was completely like a nothing trailer was the only thing. And hard to get hype after Diablo 4 is doing so well.
Yeah. I will say that the standout for me watching this trailer was just that the animations look stunning. Like, of all of the kind of isometric games that I've seen recently, there's something about the way the characters move and just the animations of the magic and everything in this just looks really beautiful and fluid, and I don't know what's going on, if it's their engine or something, but it just, I love the animations and it makes me want to play it more. Like, I don't know. There's sometimes with certain art styles and, I don't know, character design that I just feel immediately drawn to something, and this I find it hypnotic to watch.
Yeah. Path of Exile really kind of leapt to success off the kind of dissatisfaction with Diablo 3.
Yeah.
So,
well, it was free to play.
Yeah. It'll be interesting to see how Path of Exile 2 does with Diablo 4 being very well received.
Yeah.
Nicolas Cage came on stage and just talked about the fact that he's in Dead by Daylight.
Yep. I love that guy.
Good on
I want to be with you. You will feel guy. Like me.
Controversial.
I freaking love him. I actually think, no joke, he is one of the last, like, traditionally, classically Hollywood actors of our time.
And Tom Cruise.
I think he's fantastic. Yeah. I think he's been in stink movies, but I honestly, genuinely think that he is an incredible actor.
Nicolas Cage too. He's just fascinating because I just don't understand what goes on inside his head. When he came out on stage, though, I had that thing where I was just like, everyone is now so aware of the Keanu effect. He would be so aware of that coming out there and just like trying to live up to that same.
I don't think Nicolas Cage has ever tried to be anyone other than Nicolas Cage.
I think
even when he's acting.
A lot of actors will come to gaming events and be really weird and cringe and awkward. But he didn't. I think that he treated the crowd like people.
Yeah.
He was very cool, very fun, and I love that man. I do.
Love him.
Yep.
Witchfire is something that I'm excited about. It's got some of the DNA of Painkiller and Bulletstorm, some of the people that were at People Can Fly. Bulletstorm was a sick game and it was crass and stupid. This is a sick game and looks a little bit more serious, and so I'm interested in playing this. Crossfire Sierra Squad made another bit of appearance in some
I don't care
switches.
About that game.
I think we can all agree.
Yeah.
Remnant 2 got a bit of a showing. It's out July, so Remnant 2 is coming soon. From the Ashes was 2019 and reviewed really, really well as one of like the kind of Souls clones that stood out as being quite a distinct thing because of the guns that are in the game. So Remnant 2 looks like a bit of a facelift on that, and people are pretty pumped for that. Sonic Superstars. The question I had about Sonic Superstars was, has it ever been any good?
I hate you. I'm a Sonic tragic.
Yeah, this is my mascot.
A ridiculous.
It's your mascot.
You are. I hate that you said that. I mean, this is shit. Your mouth but... right now.
I watched this as he passes through the barrier into like the modern skin, and it's like cool. And I was like, that looks fucking great. And then he started running and collecting rings. And I was like, oh yeah, this game's shit.
Yeah.
Have you ever played Sonic Adventure 2 Battle?
You know how many you've said that so many times.
And I will say it again and again. And again, until it is in everybody's head and everybody's library of games they have played, because Sonic Adventure 2 Battle for the GameCube is arguably one of the best Sonic games, if not one of the best games ever made.
Well, piece of history coming soon, Derek. I would just say, like, because I love Sonic, but despite everything you just said, I don't think he ever belongs in 3D. And the reason Sonic Mania worked so well was it just embraced that Sonic only works one way, and so this did nothing, but I'm keen to see what it's like.
Yeah, I think it's cool, and I think it's cool for anyone who, because just being able to do that like sideswipey thing, Halo did it, that's such a cool feature to have.
Oh, I don't know that's in the game. I think
really?
That was just for the trailer. So
yeah, I think that was
I don't think you can toggle between.
Oh, then that's shit.
surely you can.
No, I think that was just a like, hey, look, it looks different.
Yeah, because I don't think it's a one-to-one remake. I think it is.
No, it's, yeah.
spiritual remake.
Oh, I think it's
remake.
A new game.
Yeah. Mm, yeah. Mm, mm.
Sonic.
Sonic. That's out spring. Well, it says out fall on the trailer.
And I
so I reinterpreted yeah, to spring.
Very good.
Lies of P.
Pinocchio.
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 September 19th. Again, September, October is going to be crazy.
It's going to be nuts.
There is a public demo for this as well. This was one of those, like, you can play a demo right now. So I haven't played it, but I installed it. I'm looking forward to playing it. I'll play over the weekend. And it's getting a lot of positive attention as well.
It looks beautiful.
I love Pinocchio. I think he's a beautiful little twink. And he's my friend.
Put it on the box. He's a beautiful little twink and he's my friend.
That's a little review quote that you put. He's a beautiful little twink and he's my friend.
Twink Bloodborne. Hell yeah. Sandland. Never saw this coming. And as soon as I saw a frame of it, I was like, Dragon Ball Z?
Yeah.
Yes!
It is amazing.
It is by Akira Toriyama and it is a different existing IP of Akira Toriyama's called Sandland. And it looks...
It's like Waterworld.
Cute as hell.
But
so
sand.
Excited.
But sand and land, they play so well off the tongue. Just anyway, Throne and Liberty.
What are you saying?
Bitch.
Oh, it looks so good.
Toriyama, you rube. Toriyami?
Yeah. Toriyama.
Toriyama? Did I say ye? E?
Yeah.
I wrote Toriyama. So I misread. Apologies. Throne and Liberty. There's a tech test you can sign up for. It is an MMO that Amazon Games is publishing, so it will not make it out of the tech test, just so you're aware. So if you're interested in MMOs that Amazon are attached to,
that's crazy.
Play the tech test.
That's crazy that I had no idea they're working on another MMO.
They're not developed. This isn't Amazon Game Studios developing.
NC Soft, I think.
Yeah. But they Amazon Games are publishing it. But anyway, who cares?
Are people still playing New World?
Anyway, who cares? Alan Wake 2, we saw a bit of coming on October 17th. Warhammer 40K Space Marine 2 is coming in the holiday break for us. And this trailer was about the... co-op campaign. So it revealed that there's a co-op campaign attached to this. There was a fair bit of love for the original Space Marine, and I think the more feature rich this next one is, the better.
And there's but that I'm Henry Cavill 40k it. Thing that's in the works as well. So
people love Warhammer series. And I think that's so nice.
Yeah.
I don't, not for me, but I love that people love it.
I love
the passion
it's
that they
the
have
kind of
for
thing
it.
That I wasn't sure it would endure, but it's like stood the test of time through its many mediums. It's people that just like devour Space Marine books and stuff like that as well.
And I would argue there are more bangers than there are shit games. With Warhammer
they
Fantasy and Warhammer 40K.
They have a lot of pretty cool lore to draw from. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Yes, Your Grace, Snowfall is a kind of follow-up. It's a kingdom management adventure game. And Snowfall is a glow-up on Yes, Your Grace, which is a game from a few years ago. John Carpenter's Toxic Commando again looked like a me game.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, baby.
It's developed by Saber, who have more misses than hits. But they did World War Z Aftermath, that horde, zombie horde thing. And this is based on a John Carpenter story, but I don't know it. Toxic Commando, it's a bit gung-ho. Like the world has been infected by crap, so shoot it.
John Carpenter, surely not.
By crabs.
Yeah. No, crab. Just crab. One crab. Just one really infectious crab.
Baldur's Gate 3!
Baldur's Gate 3 had a tiny little showing. Everyone who is excited about that game knows that it's coming. But this was showing off
Jason
Isaacs.
But now we have
Isaacs.
A release date.
Mm. We do have a release date. What was it? I didn't write it down.
September.
I thought we already had one for this.
August.
Sepaugust.
It's out in early access. Am I wrong? Alpha?
It's been alphas.
For quite August 31st.
August 31st.
Thank you so much. That's so soon.
I played the demo a couple of years ago, like the early access or whatever. And then I kind of stopped because I was like, I don't want to ruin the full experience for myself, but it was like hard to pull myself away from it. It was just awesome. And the storytelling is so great. And it's just, I fucking love Larian Studios so much. This is my most anticipated game of the year, and I think it will be game of the year.
And Jason Isaacs, brilliant. And a cool villain in the trailer, like a little fucking nerd bastard. Little dweeby bastard. So he's, I'm excited to, I mean, you know, that kind of caliber of voice actor attached to it. Very cool.
Yeah.
Pal World?
But you're Pikachu. Is that anything?
Yeah. I just don't
know. I'm so excited for this. It looks so stupid.
Pal World?
I
don't know. This is like a Gus game.
It's like, what if?
Because it's like Pokemon-y, but also it's like boats.
Yeah, it's like what if you could shoot Squirtle with a gun?
Sick.
It's fucked up.
Just murder that poor little guy.
Sheep with like Uzi's
sheep. And a Pokemon can cook some
Salapris.
I think people are so interested in this because it seems fake.
Yes!
Oh, wow. It totally seems like a game inside a movie making fun of
the
games.
Lamb. Totally. Yes, that totally. First trailer, it's like the emoji movie.
Yeah. That first trailer was like, oh, okay, this is like a bit. This is like someone's just been fucking around in Unreal Engine and made a trailer with some assets.
Yeah.
And they're going to get cease and desisted out.
But you know
existence.
What? It, like, they're all, everything that they've made in this, they're all enough. Not Pokemon. I think they'll be able to get away with it.
Yeah.
Because you know, there have been heaps of games that it looks like Pokemon. just a Pokemon gun sweatshop just showing up while I talk about how like it's actually fun. But
do you think there's like a massive like
it's so sad. Yeah.
Do you think a massive room of artists who are drawing Pokemon and then somebody comes around with like a Wacom pen and is just like, now it's fine.
It's just, and that's Lucario, whatever it's called.
Oh,
dude.
Man.
That's wild.
It's
I think this is
so
going to be
close.
Game of the year.
Look, I mean,
truly.
It's apparently entering early access January 24.
Melodic Storm says it's like if you asked AI to draw Pokemon. That's very
well.
Black Desert has an expansion coming in the Land of Morning Light. I can't believe it's still making content for that game. The base game came out in 2014, but that's one of those.
That's like an
those
old
MMOs
anime
that keeps
MMO.
On giving.
Mm.
We saw the Lord of the Rings. I wrote Returns to Moria. Is that what it was called?
Return
to Moria. Yep.
Return to Moria.
Mm-hmm.
I wrote that and I found the trailer and I attached it to the thing that I wrote and I still don't believe it's called that.
Can you play Golem?
The title of the trailer is Return to Moria TM, so they've obviously got a registered trademark. Either.
There you go.
You play Golem in it?
You don't play as Golem in
it. I don't care about it.
You play, it's a survival crafting game set in the fourth age of Middle Earth.
What was that swing? Did you see that?
Yeah.
Boring.
Boring.
Look at this swing. Wait for it. I slowed it down.
Swing, bada.
Watch
it'll
it.
Come.
Like,
it'll come.
It's next shot, next shot, next shot.
Come on.
Next shot.
One more shot.
Next shot.
Hold on. We got this.
Here it is.
He missed.
Oh, he put his whole dwarf pussy into that. Damn. He's like, Ali, you.
And he missed. And he missed. Banishes. Why did we spend so much time on this fucking trailer?
And for what?
Banishes Ghosts of New Eden. We should spend a bit of time on. Don't Nod, doing action RPG. Mm-hmm. The first we saw of it, the trailer was really intriguing, and then it said Don't Nod at the end. It was like, no fucking way. And this time they put their name right at the front. Your character has. There still seems to be a lot of story, which they are I wouldn't say the masters of, but very, very good at it is what they do. So I'm really interested in the action in this. It actually looks quite good, and it looks like the action is about being tied to those kind of emotional decisions, and it still feels like a Don't Nod game in that context. Mm. So I'm really keen to check out what
they've
pulled off here.
They've got quite a few games in the works, haven't they? Am I wrong?
I think they do.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know of anything that isn't in the realms of like sad teenagers.
Yeah. Teenagers really do be sad when you think about it.
For good reason.
Yeah. It's so hard being a teenager. They're definitely not the best years of your life.
You would know at 19.
Yeah, I'm 19 years old, by the way.
Like a Dragon Gaiden The man who erased his name, we're not going to show the trailer because we got banned from all platforms for showing a tiny little ass.
Just a little booty.
We got banned?
Well, just video, our video got taken down.
Yeah, our video got taken down because we showed some itchy barn ass. And it's like, who doesn't want to see that? I think everybody wants to see it, and I think it's good that we saw it. I'd like to see it again. Can we chuck it up on the screen? Chuck it up on the screen.
Just put
that is fine. I'm thinking
put
about
pockety
it.
Butt over
I got it.
It
in my head.
Yeah, we should have
pockety butt over itchy butt.
I think there is no such thing as too many Like a Dragon games. I want them to keep releasing at this speed. I love it. I love Like a Dragon games so
and
much.
And itchy bun entering the United States of America.
But this that's infinite wealth.
Oh, this is the connective tissue between
Dragon Gaiden, the man who erased his name.
Between
so that, this is
it's a character connection between Yakuza 6 and Like a Dragon,
Eight.
Apologies.
But well, hey,
no
buttons.
We
can
play.
We can play this one.
We can show this one.
We can show this one.
There's no buttons in this one.
Chuck it up. And hey, chuck the ass one up too.
No, show the ass.
Just put it up for a second, maybe.
Why not?
While we're at it.
Can you put a? Do you have the power to put a pockety butt on screen and hold it with your mouse and just track it manually?
Maybe in the ad break we'll have time to prepare for that.
It's in the next show.
It looks so good. It looks amazing. But Like a Dragon games always look amazing. I played Yakuza 0 for the first time the other day, and I was just still in awe. Just around how good that it looks.
Beautifully lit.
Every single one of them.
If you've ever been to Japan, it's always always feels like they've replicated the just little kind of characteristics of cities really well.
I felt that when playing Ghostwire Tokyo for the first time and then playing this, I was like, oh yeah, maybe I don't even need to go to Japan. Just play video games.
This is out November 9th. I should also point out that Banishes Ghosts of Eden, the Don't Nod game, is out at the end of this year. Under the Waves is coming August 29th. It is developed by Parallel Studio and has been marred by the publishing from Quantic Dream. But it is a really a cool, moody trailer. Fae Farm is out September 8th. It is just cottagecore farming cuteness coming to Switch and PC. Marvel Snap is getting an update. There's a new mode for Conquest.
Cottagecore, that makes me happy.
King Arthur Legend Rise is hilarious because it is a European fantastical history displayed as a JRPG. Excalibur is 80 feet tall and on fire. And I fucking love that.
Is it a mobile game?
It is a mobile game that's also on PC. So it's it's built as a mobile game. Wayfinder is coming to early access this winter. For us, so soon.
This is the one that looks like it's like a cross, but it looks like a cross between World of Warcraft and Fortnite.
It is. It's a crazy, colorful MMO, and some reporters who have had time with it have said that it's actually a really good MMO grind. They've been excited by the. It's very grindy, but it's been a fun grind, which the people who are playing World of Warcraft might be into, because they love to fucking grind.
Yeah. I wonder what the quest sort of system is like, because it's where most MMOs fall down.
Yeah. I'll quickly power through. Stellaris Nexus is a multiplayer 4X game. Apparently, its selling point is that it respects your time in that the whole 4X game lasts about an hour, which is about 150 hours shorter than most 4X rounds. So that's cool. You kind of get a fast-track experience of a 4X game. Space Trash Scavenger is wishlistable now. There's no release date for it, but it is about exploring derelict spaceships and stuff.
Collecting
a few games
trash.
Like it, collecting trash. Star Trek Infinite, there's a reveal tomorrow, June 16th. Mm-hmm. Apparently that's Picard Day.
Yeah, right.
Didn't know that. Really no clue what this is. The developer is Nimble Giant Entertainment. Obviously they got their hands on a beautiful IP. And they recently made a couple of the games that this development studio have made recently are Masters of Orion Conquer the Stars, which is a 4X game, which would work well with a skin of Star Trek. But also they made Quantum League, which is a quite well-received FPS.
Oh, right.
So there could be some design in this that's like, I mean, it's strategy.
Yeah.
But it's coming from a team that are pretty good at everything they crack at, take a crack at. So
that's sick.
Yeah. Cool. This one's a challenge to get the tongue around. Lisfunga, the time shift warrior. It's a hack and slash with like time warping. The neat little thing that it shows in the trailer is like, you know, it's kind of a Hades looking hack and slash, but you run up and attack one enemy, you reset time, you run up, attack another enemy, and you see the ghosts of your other passes moving through. So there's going to be some interesting strategy with that.
That's really cool.
Yeah. Immortals of Avon, we've seen the first person major shooter.
Can I just say?
Yep.
I don't care about that.
You can.
Because you said that last time. Still doesn't care.
So I don't care about that.
No change.
Still doesn't care.
No change.
We should move on.
But hey, we don't have to.
Fortnite got a big update and there was a massive trailer of the wilds. It went crazy.
Little Optimus Prime.
And they wrapped up, this show wrapped up with Final Fantasy VII Rebirth, which is coming early 2024. It is going to be available on two discs.
Yeah. And that's the one where Cloud gives birth.
Yeah. And I made a note because I felt this was important, that even Yuffie, who first came back in Final Fantasy VII Remake's DLC, showed up in the trailer. So Yuffie's going to be there.
Thank goodness.
Can't wait to see Yuffie.
Been hidden so long.
I mean, that's a better name than Clive.
That's true.
I don't know about that.
Yuffie.
I know a Clive when I see one. A Yuffie?
And Aerith? Is Aerith a name in... Line? Is that a name in...
Maybe. Yiffie?
I almost said Sephiroth, but I know that's Kingdom Hearts.
Isn't Yiffing the thing that furries do?
It's the thing that furries do, that's right.
And the only other note that I have from this is that Party Animals got a release date September 20.
Oh,
Party
so Animals. Excited.
We've been waiting for 400 years for that.
So long for that. Huge.
Yeah. Huge. Day of the Devs, do you want to run us through that?
It's time for Day of the Devs, baby. It's my favorite showcase every year. I love it. I'm a big fan of the Double Fine game. I think they're really cool. And I think they always show off really good shit. And let's start with Beastie Ball. Beastie Ball is Pokemon Volleyball. I think that's the way to describe it. Pokemon Volleyball. And it's made by the same people that made Chicory, A Colorful Tale, which was a fantastic game that reminded me a lot of Paper Mario Color Splash, except you're a little dog with a big old paintbrush and the world is black and white and you can freaking paint it. It rocks. This looks awesome. Yeah. I'm very excited.
Yeah. Interesting. Dodgeball games have been like making a scene. There was like Dodgeball Academy.
Yeah.
Like similar JRPG style turn-based combat.
Yep.
Yeah.
Throwing balls at each other. It's hot right now. It's a new card.
It is so hot right now. I can't remember. There was a game plan game that I read out a while back that it was like, this is like an emotional storytelling relationship game, but also basketball.
So it's like anime. Yeah. Awesome. And then we've got Hyperlight Breaker, which is a bright, colorful multiplayer roguelite set in procedurally generated open worlds. If you couldn't tell, it's made from the creators of Hyperlight Drifter.
Camera's lower.
Lower. It looks great. Very excited. And then there's Simpler Times. And I wrote here in capital letters, so you know it's real, incredibly chill vibes game. You live through the memories of the main character across the span of 10 years and all four seasons. And you basically, you know, go through your memories, painting, playing a record, looking through your room, just like doing little chill, nice things. Yeah. And it looks very pretty.
It's not just that they're surrounded by plants, but you can tell that those people have like 80 plants that they nurse. Their children. Plants are their children.
I would love to watch like that
shot.
4 hours.
It was like they push the camera on track through the on dolly through the grass.
Of footage of them just kind of talking about the inspiration and vibe of their game. They just seem like those kind of people.
They would make you a cup of tea and it's made with the most love one could ever experience.
And it would have been made from like rose hips they grew from their garden.
Oh yeah. Oh. I want to meet them. Anyway, Viewfinder, I've been very excited for this game for a while. It's a very cool puzzle platformer where you take photos and then you can walk into them. You put them out in the spot. And then they become part of the world.
So good.
And you know, you change your perspective.
I don't understand.
Right? It's very confusing, but it's also amazing. Like basically,
I get very caught up in taking photos in games. Like it becomes if they have a photo function.
It's so good.
Doof
it. And now it's an environment.
Yeah.
And it made it look more stagnant, but it's like. Nothing.
Like it's boom. Yeah. It's such an awesome,
so cool.
Awesome concept. And there's a demo on PS5.
Yeah.
So try it out. Oh, like look at this. You can make stairs just by putting the
so cool.
I immediately need to see like a behind the scenes how they have made this.
Yeah. Yeah.
I love it.
It almost feels like it was an accident when they were building an engine or building a game and they're like, hang on.
Part of me feels like I've seen something like that before.
Superliminal was the one where it's like you'd pick up an object.
Superliminal's
And it was far away and it'd be huge.
It changes perspective.
Yeah. So it's kind of extrapolating on that idea.
Yeah.
Try it out on PS5. It's
super cool.
I quite like the fact that they've made those things black and white so that you can immediately see the thing that you've placed into that. Otherwise, it would seamlessly kind of integrate itself so quickly.
Like, where'd it go?
Was that always there?
Yeah.
And Viewfinder's coming out on July 18th as well.
Sick.
So get on that. And then there's Haunty. You're a ghost and you haunt the mysterious world around you. I don't know too much about this one, but like it looks very cool. I love the art style of it.
I like the idea that they were calling it Haunty as a placeholder and then they came to release time and they were just like, so have you decided on a name? And I'm like, Haunty. I guess Haunty works.
It's a Haunty game.
There were two eyes. Haunty. Like the Wii.
The Wii.
And then we got Cart Life. Which I'm very excited for, like purely based on the fact that it's such, I believe, an important game in indie game history. So this game originally came out around 10 years ago, and the dev who made it, it won a bunch of awards. It was quite incredible as a game, just because like it explored just the simplicity of life. In the lives of the three protagonists that you can play, that they run these food carts, and you know it's just very like simple everyday life. It's mundane, but it's incredible. You know, like it's showing the beauty of the mundane, right? Mm-hmm. And then the creator of the game decided to pull it down from Steam and make it, you know, inaccessible because it was apparently mired with bugs. It was unfinished, and he just wasn't in a place to fix that. Mm-hmm. And so he just took it down because he wasn't happy with it.
Aww.
And then years and years and years later, I forgot who it was, but
was it available anywhere?
It was available. No, it was gone. And the developer just kind of disappeared. He decided to do some other things in his life, get some life experience. And then, years later, someone managed, I forgot who, and I should know and need to do my research, but someone got in touch with him and was like, I want to bring this back. And he was like, all right. And so basically they've been working together to bring this game back to life, and it's coming.
Wow.
And, but.
Ah!
And I think that's incredibly cool.
I love stories like that when people are just like, this person would have been fixating on this for years and been man, people need to see this game. Mm. People need to experience this game, and I'm going to make it happen.
Yeah, I'm very excited for this one. And then we got Hellscape, which to me was a personal surprise because this is coming from, I believe, the studio of Quebble Cop, who is a YouTuber.
You just made that word up.
you think,
all words are made
up. This is true. But it's Tony Hawk meets, I'd say, Hades. Like, yeah. It's... a demonic hack and slash I wouldn't say Hades. I'd say Devil May Cry. That is a better my brain. But it looks cool as hell, and I wasn't expecting this from a YouTuber. but slay. And that being said, I wasn't expecting this from a YouTuber is a phrase that I said, but I loved Dream Daddy. And also Poglings from Chadtronic looks amazing. So like, you know, anybody can get into game
Any
development.
Any YouTuber can get into game development.
Exactly.
I didn't know Dream Daddy came from a YouTuber.
It came from Game Grumps.
All right.
Yeah.
Windows has an update for us.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, Windows update.
we'll do it later.
Yeah. And then we got Henry half head, which is Cappy gone rogue, baby. that is like my first thing that came to mind. You are half of a head, and you can take over things. I think it looks ridiculous and amazing. I love it.
So, because we can't see it on screen.
Oh, we can't see it on screen.
If you were to describe it, okay, would you so say that you are the bottom half of the head or the top half of the head?
Imagine this.
Mm-hmm. Can you talk? No, because
the mouth
you don't
is gone.
Have a mouth.
Yeah, okay. It's above the mouth,
but
no below
mouth,
the nose.
Therefore, I cannot scream.
But just very expressive eyes.
So big eyes, mm-hmm. nose. Oh. Ah, there he is. So
oh, and
you
rounded.
Are half of a head, and you can bounce around and turn into anything.
I don't like it.
I love it. I think it's
it makes me uncomfortable.
It's like mouthful Whoa. Mode. Yeah. It's like Cappy. It's giving half of a head. Becoming other things mm-hmm. because that's what it is.
That's exactly what it
and
is.
And I love it. I'm very excited.
I don't like it.
Very cool.
And then there's that's Cocoon, a game where you are a little moth guy and you can jump into worlds and then jump into other worlds inside those worlds and then also jump into other worlds inside
Which
those.
I believe they first showed this last year.
Yeah.
Did they? No. Maybe.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Imagine a director that knows what sees some action.
Oh dear.
But it's made by the people who made Inside and Limbo.
Wow.
It looks incredibly different.
They turned the lights on.
Yeah.
Last year at Xbox Showcase.
That's
they colored it in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Crazy.
That's sick.
So nice.
And then we've got Ete.
Hmm?
Ete.
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 Ed. Which is what if I've mentioned Paper Mario Color Splash twice now, but what if Paper Mario Color Splash was French?
Mm.
Mario would say "wee wee" instead of "wahoo." Am I right? Am I right? I have no respect. But yeah, you paint.
But "wee wee" means yes, yes. I mean, it still would be a cry of elation.
Yeah,
I think they say "wahoo" in France.
They would say "wahoo."
I've never heard a French person
they
say
might
wahoo.
Say, he might say...
They're not that happy.
No.
Sacre bleu.
Yeah.
They say,
oh mon dieu. Yeah.
Potentially.
French.
But it's actually, it's a beautiful game.
Formidable.
Oh, formidable.
Formidable.
Yeah, which is formidable.
Yeah.
Oh, ah.
Oh, ah. Formidable.
What's that?
What?
Oh, ah.
Ah. It's what they say.
Oh, ah. Oh, ah. It sounds like the noise like a character in an RPG with me.
They've been shocked by something.
Ah,
ça fucked on bien.
Whoa!
What did you say just then?
That's what it says.
That's so good. That's a grumpy Mario.
Oh, ça fonctionne bien.
That sounded like Mandarin.
How do you say woo-woo? Oh, that's too many things. Yeah. You should just say woo-woo.
Summer Hill.
Yeah.
Bits.
Summer Hill. What if? Being a shepherd that, what did I write here? What if being a shepherd that herds sheep was a mysterious and magical experience? Oh, it already is? Well, it is more magical and mysterious now.
It sounds like thoughts that you've woken up in the middle of the night and you've scrolled on a piece of paper beside your bed. You're like, okay,
that
what
guy
if?
Is woolly.
The He's only way I can describe games is like looking at it and my first thought and immediately writing it down.
Yeah. That's a Jared Leto.
Yeah.
From the side.
Oh, he kind of do. He's got great eyebrows. He's got great hair.
It's morbid.
Oh,
time.
My God.
He doesn't have to gel those. They just come out that way.
Yeah.
Good for him. Get that shit out of there. Eternites is an anime dating sim where you are also fighting monsters in a post-apocalyptic world. And that's what it is.
Mm. Yeah.
And it's that.
I think that's good.
Well, she's dancing.
Yeah. So you basically, you're like, monsters, but you're also like, please fuck me, anime girl.
Oh my gosh. What?
Yeah.
Everyone has the same school uniform always.
I honestly, I'm not a big fan because I think you should be able to fuck the monsters.
All's equal in love and monster
exactly.
fucking.
I feel like that's a large subsect of porn in general.
Yeah.
Mm. They should do like Street Fighter 6. Like how you just go up to fight anyone in the street.
Oh, yeah.
It's just like you.
You want to
go? You can actually do that in real life as well. You just go up to people. No. And then we've got Retro Gadgets, which looks sick. You make little gadgets. You build little things. You build little gadgets. It rocks.
Yeah.
It's so cool. Like it's a pixelated little gadget building.
I always look at these games and I'm like, there's so many things we do in video games that we could be doing in real life, but we prefer to do a digitized simulation of it.
Oh, yeah.
And it's so funny that we become so obsessed with, like, it's like,
And the cool thing is you can make a little game machine in the game and then you can play a game on that machine. It's so freaking cool.
Our aversion to like real world activities. There is no end to what we will replicate.
But here's something that you can't do in the real world, and it's be a Mars rover. Segway. Mars first logistics, baby. Yeah. I am so fucking excited for this game. I played a demo of it last year, I think during a Steam Next Fest.
Mm-hmm.
It is a Melbourne made game. Shouts out Ian, I love your work. I'm so excited. I am I'm deeply obsessed with this game. It's like Death Stranding meets Lego 2K Drive, and it's also set on Mars.
There's something very sexy about that jiggle.
Oh yeah, the little bounce.
I was watching it. I was watching it earlier today, and I was like, wow.
And the music's done by Dan Golding, mm-hmm. who is a legend. And yep. Like, this is just
worked on Untitled Goose Game.
That's right. And that sucks. I'm so excited for this game. It's just based on the demo alone, it is so special. Like, it is such a special game. Everything about it is just chef's kiss. It looks beautiful. It plays beautiful. I'm so excited for this.
Look at the bounce. My money don't jiggle, jiggle. It falls. You wiggle, wiggle. Oh, sure.
It's such a brilliant, simple concept, and I can just see how much I'm going to want to finish every level with a perfect machine.
It's so much trial and error. Mm. It's crazy.
It feels like it's coming the perfect time after Zelda as well. No! It's like a more refined, expanded version of that.
What if there was no Link and there was only a really weird car that you made?
The key to this trailer is showing you failing at things, because it instantly makes you be like, I could do better.
I can fix that.
It's like mobile.
She's pregnant. In a really cold home.
Cold and this one needs gold. Who? What are you going to do? How are you going to pull the pins?
Don't pull the pins like that. You're gonna melt the child with like molten gold.
Oh no, she's pregnant and she's covered in mud and she fell over and her boyfriend left her. And also pins. She's in a cold, cold house.
My favorite ones are like, this lady wants her bathroom redone, and then it's like purple, pink stripes, yellow polka dots, tartan, and it's like this old lady going,
hitch it with hammer.
And it's like, could you do better? And it's like, I don't know.
Can you impress this old bitch?
We can't.
And then finally, we've got Salt Sea Chronicles, which is a story-driven adventure game from the makers of I always pronounce this wrong. Mutazione?
Mutazione.
Mutazione. And Sports Friends. It looks great.
Sports Friends.
Sports Friends.
Mario.
Woohoo.
Oh,
formidable.
It looks great. It looks like lots of fun. And that's freaking it.
Yeah, that was a huge, and that was, obviously we did a bit of PlayStation, but that was the first day. It was Summer Games Fest. Whoa. Straight into Day of Devs.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to have a bit of a, we're going to have a quick ad break, and then there's heaps more. Xbox, Ubisoft, there's round. PC Gamer. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
We've already covered some of the stuff that
we didn't include Wholesome Games because there were over 70 games.
Yeah.
But let me tell you, I loved it. And that's what's important.
Ad break. What'd you get?
Rabbit food. Again? I think mine's still growing. What about you?
Cat food.
You blokes want anything from the shops?
Bloody Ripper. Bloody unreal.
Oh, what the f***?
is that? Oh, Struth, this tastes like John Howard's dick. And I'd know. I just threw up in my mouth. I think it tasted better. Where's that cat food? Maybe that'll taste better. Oh, this isn't worse taste than Academy Award-winning actress Scarlett Johansson playing an Asian woman.
Oh, where the f*** did these come from? Oh.
Evil's Pie Boy. The worst Australian taste.
Lego 2K Drive lets you build almost any vehicle you can think up. So here's some fun pop culture builds for a bit of inspiration.
Atomic batteries to power, turbines to speed.
It's the Adam West Batmobile. There's some hinge usage here to get those wings popping, so it's a medium challenge build. The Doctor's TARDIS is a mandatory build for any fans of the Time Lord. It is an easy build, but a tad wibbly wobbly. Listen up, 007, Bond's Lotus Esprit from The Spy Who Loved Me is much more than a car. It's also a boat. The group mode function is super handy here, as you can copy over builds between transport modes, but it's still a medium level build. Which car were you planning on? Well, whichever one I build. Well, let's head to Isla Nublar with the Jurassic Park Jeep. This easy build is more about its iconic colors than its complexities. And finally, if you're rushing home to check on your aunt and uncle, why not try Luke's Landspeeder? The X34's tri-engines are a little finicky, so it's a hard build for a more civilized age of racing.
We are, sound the freaking alarm! Ruby Innes!
Welcome, Ruby Innes. My name is Ruby Innes, and good fucking day to you.
Ruby Innes.
My name is Ruby Innes, and all right, what up? I'm Goblin Ruby. You're not gonna believe this. It is just furry porn. Furry porn.
Furry porn. Furry porn.
Have you ever met God? Hello, freaks, geeks, haters, lovers, losers, and winners. Welcome to Back Pocket, a show where we determine whether or not video games are real or if they're just something we made up as a joke.
Oh my gosh.
Thank you.
The slow-mo was so beautiful.
She's crying.
That was so bad.
Who drew those horrible pictures?
It was me.
Nasty person.
Thank you. That was amazing. Thank you so much. Oh my gosh. Sincere posting. I'm being silly again. Oh, poopa pee pee.
That was Muso for Hire. Word from sponsor from Muso for Hire there. Thank you so much. It was a song from sponsor there. Mm. And Grim Pixel as well. And we also saw the pie ad for Evil Spybo. And you're amazing, Lego 2K
doing well.
Drive.
Doing well on the TikToks.
That's it deserves TikTok. To, man. It's the best thing we've ever made.
Thank you.
And I wasn't here.
Yeah.
So that's probably why. Right.
Before we continue, can I ask if anyone would like some Fruchtgelle?
Oh, I'd love some Fruchtgelle.
Some Jordbeerfiske?
Oh, some Jordbeerfiske.
Some Lakritz Butter?
Uh-huh.
Festplatte?
Some what?
Or banana?
The second last one?
Festplatte?
Face platter.
Don't mind. I think it means party plate.
Oh, yeah. It kind of looks like a plate of party.
Yeah.
Can we get a zoom in on that?
Oh, yeah. That's a heap.
It looks exactly like you think it would. Cause it...
Try the Jordbeerfiske.
Oh, wow. What's which?
The Jordbeerfiske.
Hey, good.
Yeah, the fish.
The fish. Now, I was scrambling then because I was ill prepared for what's about to happen.
It's kind of like I've been entertaining the crowd.
You have been. I know. Scott, you heard that. Scotty's understanding now.
Mm-hmm.
Scotty, come.
Scotty!
Come on.
Now she thinks she's going to get some Jordbeerfiske and she's not.
No,
oh,
she's not.
Some fist it's platter. The
fish. She's going to come up here. Up.
Get up, girl.
Good girl, Scotty.
We got a lot more to get through.
Ass.
Let's see some more Key 3.
Hello.
Welcome to Keel 3.
And his amazing friends. We're not going to talk about Will Arnett.
Well, never.
Why was he so tired?
Why not?
He just doesn't come up.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
If Gus was here, he'd be talking about the podcast. Podcast that he hates, but listens to every single week.
Smartless.
Oh, my God.
Is he on it?
Yeah.
Will Arnett.
But it's like, Gus loves talking about things that he hates. So he's just like, it's like the worst thing I've ever listened to. It's so bad. And it's just like, it's all they do is just like ads. And it's just like so shoddily done. And then the following week, he'll be like, so this week when I was listening to Smartless, I'm like, why are you listening to it if you hate it so much?
What a strange, strange individual. Let's all say what we like the least about him right now. Just kidding. We love Gus.
So this time, Key 3 is brought to us by Middle C. Middle C, a lovely, lovely human being, and also the purveyor of songs written in the key of C, until we're told they're not by Muso for Hire. I just scrambled to find one. This may not be in the key of C.
It's hard to find.
I'm going
to
read some lyrics.
A resource.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because they're all wrong.
Yeah.
Here's some lyrics for you. Are you somewhere feeling lonely, or is someone loving you? Tell me how to win your heart, for I haven't got a clue. But let me start by saying, I love you. I'm going to skip a little line. Because I wonder where you are, and I wonder what you do. Are you somewhere feeling lonely, or is someone loving you?
Song,
tell me.
Hello, is it me you're looking for?
Wow. It is Lionel.
I can see it.
Serious.
Made famous for the Herbie Fully Loaded film where Herbie sees a love bug, like a current love bug, and tries to kiss it, but it can't. It gets a car.
Cars can't kiss.
Cars can't kiss.
No. It's so sad.
Cars can't kiss.
They don't have anything at the front to go
lips. Do you ever get sad about cars not kiss? I wish cars had lips so they could kiss each other.
Yeah.
But then Freddie would run away.
Well, Fado says that's an A minor, isn't it?
Not the way I sing it.
No.
It's the beauty of songs.
Yeah.
It's crazy though. Cars can fuck. Did you know that?
Really?
They can't kiss.
Each other, but each other? Humans. I know that.
Yeah.
All right.
Xbox Showcase.
I just saw that movie with Cameron Diaz.
The Counselor.
Mm. Oh, The Mask? Yes.
Do they
I love that
thing?
Movie.
What? Stay on the
Xbox.
Xbox. Xbox. Showcase. You've already wrapped this up. So we can power through it. You wrapped it up on our socials. But there was just balls to the wall.
Mm.
Cool stuff in this one. Fable, we knew was coming. Haven't seen it in ages. We're like, it's probably not going to happen.
Mm.
Playground Games rocks up as the very first frame.
So excited.
Sick. Richard Ayoade sits
Hello,
in.
Hello, it's me.
So amazing.
Funny. I'm big in this one. Yeah.
What if Richard Ayoade was this big?
So,
yeah,
he's big and everyone else is small?
It's Jack and the Beanstalk.
He's
the
giant.
Beanstalk. He's the giant of that story.
Yeah. He's atop the Beanstalk because he's the giant.
Yeah. And there's a bunch of in-engine stuff here, which just looks beautiful. It's why I go, Alan Wake, maybe not the best looking game this generation. Mm. Humor on point.
Yeah.
It looks beautiful. Who is not keen to play Fable?
I'm so excited.
Idiots. I know.
You see that handheld camera shot?
I love it. The only thing that doesn't work perfectly in this is Ayoade's facial animation. Yeah.
It's
a bit rubbery and
it's not quite him.
It's not perfect.
Especially for someone who has so much personality, recognizable personality in the way they like deliver lines.
Yeah.
It's hard to see that some of that lost.
Totally. I love the Fable games. I'm excited or hopeful for this Fable game to look like the Fable trailer. Because there have been many times of Fable games not looking like the Fable trailer.
That was the Molyneux effect, though.
I'm curious as to what is the gameplay going to be similar to the previous Fables? Like, is it going to be that kind of structure?
I hope so.
Yeah, they like the snippets that they show in that third person action RPG.
you would gain weight in Fable, and you would have to lose weight by eating celery.
Oh my god, yes, I didn't do it on purpose, but I managed to make myself this like giant beefy muscly broad like out of nowhere, but also everybody loved me, and I very specifically remember
marrying all of the sex workers in like the bad town.
I got into so much trouble.
I married all of them and put them in different houses throughout the land.
They find each other.
And they were not happy with me. But
mine found each other and it caused quite a dust up.
Yeah, they were not happy at all. But I was, you know, I loved them all equally.
Tell you what though, I never got an STD.
Mm.
Gog, on the other hand. You know, it would come up like in the loading screen with like your friend's achievements and stats and stuff. And it'd be like, Gog, you know, 7 STDs. I'm like,
more than that.
Put a glove on it, mate.
More than
Body.
That.
Put a glove on it. Jeez. Oh, yeah,
yeah.
Then we saw South of Midnight, which was a really cool.
Oh, God. The
stop
motion.
Out of nowhere trailer. Sorry?
The stop motion looks amazing. Mm, yeah.
So this is it may be actually hidden by what we're doing, by our faces here, but this specifies that this is in-engine footage.
Mm-hmm.
This is Compulsion Games, and they did We Happy Few, so you probably recognize the art style from that. Mm. This is just a mood, this trailer.
So cool.
And sets up kind of a mythological dark fantasy but like southern US kind of vibe. Super cool. The swamps of Louisiana. We're not in Louisiana, but
the bayou.
We're in the bayou.
Cool.
Next we saw Star Wars Outlaws, which Ubisoft went into more detail on, but Xbox Showcase had the first trailer. The
cinematic.
And this cinematic was pretty specky.
Yeah.
I mean, Star Wars, the original trilogy Star Wars is so visually striking that I'm always excited when I see it, and have been let down by that in the past. But as soon as we're in this era of Star Wars, I'm all in.
Totally.
And this is doing a thing that we've wanted from Star Wars for a while, which is like, you don't have to put fucking Jedi and Skywalkers in everything.
Yeah.
Mm.
So
I love this little creature.
Yeah.
But I would love to see a yucky little creature that's annoying. I want to see a glup shitter. Like I want to see an ugly, yucky, weird little guy who is there for too long. His voice is grating.
Mm.
And he might actually make the game harder for you. I want that.
Yeah.
I love the wolf cut on this chick. Very on trend. Mm. Very popular hairstyle right now. This thing looks like a cross between a porg and like
an axolotl.
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Yeah. It's got a bit cute. Loth cat.
It's I don't know if you got this, but I feel like the film that it's most closely aping is the Solo film.
Totally. 100%. Yeah.
Justin, I mean, she's it's wearing the smuggler, Solo jacket.
Yeah.
She's racing through city streets.
And she's a bounty hunter.
And she's a... Is she a bounty hunter?
I'm fairly certain.
Or is she a scoundrel?
They've said that, it's one of those
A good bounty hunter is a scoundrel in Star Wars, you see.
And is this...
look at this guy with this trench coat, man. Look at this guy.
I was just saying, and we can't linger on these things. The guy in the ship, that's Render, I think is the one.
Yeah.
Like, he looks just like him, but she says a different name. I don't know if that's going to be a re-canonizing kind of thing.
Maybe.
Which would be cool.
And I saw a lot of action on Twitter about I would fuck that robot.
Oh, yeah.
Robot
kind of slick with it.
Hot vibes.
Yeah. We'll see more of him in the gameplay, but he's got a good walk animation.
Mm. Yeah. And this is a Ubisoft game.
I like the color palette.
Mm. Yeah. So, the only, like,
Josh, do you want to do the gameplay? We might as well talk.
Yeah.
All Outlaw at the moment.
That's all right. A little bit of the fear of it for me is that it will be Far Cry reskin, and we'll get onto Avatar because Avatar is a Far Cry reskin.
Yeah.
Well, I think if anything, this is Wildlands, like Ghost Recon.
Yes,
it's definitely got that DNA in it a lot more than, like, Far Cry is kind of the Ubisoft thing, and then everything kind of sprinkles out of that.
Yeah.
But I like the section where she's on a little speed bike, felt like Wildlands just driving through stuff, which could be good, but I'm the same. Like, I don't really want to rinse repeat. I'd love new things in there, but I guess we'll see.
Rogoth says also microtransactions is a fear from Ubisoft.
Mm.
I actually think Ubisoft do it better than anyone else.
Yeah.
You have to pay real money to fuck the robot, I heard.
Yeah.
It's an attachment.
they always hide the fucking content behind a paywall, the Ubisoft team. Mm.
Yeah.
They're typically really good at supporting the game with content. They've proven that they can do that. And
a Star Wars game with like the support of Valhalla and stuff. Yeah, it's just constant.
Just really good cadence of content delivery. And it's mostly interesting cosmetics that, and playful stuff that they do if they want to, if they're trying to incentivize microtransactions outside of new content DLC. So I'm hesitant because you have to be with Star Wars these days, but
I'm just so glad there's no laser swords in sight.
Yeah,
I'm happy for that.
Yep.
Yeah.
30 what? Lord?
No, it's just cute.
The Geek Corner?
No, yeah, I just feel like I love how seriously you take it.
Yeah. Star Wars is life.
We're eating.
Star Wars is life. Also, just before we move on, big note thing is that it's set between 4 and 5 as well, which is a big, because usually they just take the sides of trilogies.
There's so many the bigger gaps are between the trilogies, but there's, I mean, I harp on about this all the time. Sorry, 5 and 6 because Solo's already in Carbonite. That's fine.
There's like 20 movies now. Where do the numbers lie?
But the
gameplay.
Yeah. So sick.
And they released it ultra wide. That's weird.
Yeah.
That was a strange thing. I don't think a gameplay reveal has ever just been.
Just for me and my monitor.
And my monitor.
And Josh's monitor. Yes, I do have a problem with Disney going like, there was an interesting throwaway line, let's make a whole fucking movie about it. But
you were like, we have to power through the next section. We got so many games.
33 Immortals, Thunder Lotus. But this is in two sections. So we're
in two dots done.
33 Immortals by Thunder Lotus. To me, didn't look like much until big fat graphic pops up on screen and says, with 33 player co-op.
Yeah, it's made, it's made by the people who made Spiritfarer. So I was not expecting anything like that. Wow. I loved Spiritfarer.
I wonder if this is designed for like stream culture where they're just like wanting people to kind of get community in on this while live streaming it.
Oh my God.
Feels like it.
33 co-op. That's so crazy.
That's chaos.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Sorry, my thing crashed. I think the next
edit.
Sorry?
Payday 3.
No, sorry. Payday 3.
Yeah, Payday 3. Yep. Payday 3. I'm a huge Payday 2 fan. Mm-hmm. This looks like it hasn't evolved much, but I'll take more of Payday.
I'm excited because I feel like I missed the social boat of Payday, so I'm excited to kind of get in on it this time around.
Definitely the Good Game team got heaps into it.
Yeah.
And it's fun to attack. And people have tried to do similar things, and I don't think have done it anywhere near as well as Payday 2 did, so gimme. Avowed. This is Obsidian's RPG with magic fingies.
I think this is the one that I get that I've been confusing with Immortals. Is the one. This is the one that's Bioshocky. Yeah. People have described this as like Destiny-esque,
it's magic,
but with
you got magic.
You got magic.
Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't heard the comparison to Destiny. In my head, it was going to be like Outer Worlds. Other Wilds.
No, now I'm confusing it with Immortals. God damn it.
Yeah. Because it is going to be a character story focused RPG, if it's anything like Obsidian's other work.
Yeah.
And with a fish that you can fuck.
Yeah.
Speaking of fish that you can fuck, Sea of Thieves has done a little crossover.
Hold on.
You can fish them up and then fuck them.
Okay.
Has got a crossover event happening with Legend of, well, The Secret of Monkey Island. It's a Monkey Island crossover called Sea of Thieves, The Legend of Monkey Island is the next campaign or story batch for Sea of Thieves. That's pretty cool.
It looked really cute.
Yeah, I always like to jump back into Sea of Thieves whenever they introduce story stuff. It's definitely like the best part of the game, I think. So I find it hard to kind of stay invested in between, even with all the new stuff they've added. The story stuff kind of is a real motivator.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's cool.
My heart like fluttered when that popped up because I was like holding for Indiana Jones.
Yeah.
And I was like, Xbox, LucasArts. And then that game's dead. They're working on Wolfenstein 3. They've just moved on.
Nah,
I don't know.
I reckon they got something, but I reckon they're struggling to make the whip work.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I talk about it?
Insider goss. I've got no insider information. Yeah. That I just reckon it'd be hard to get a whip to work in an interesting way.
I've used a whip in a game.
Yeah, but was it good?
Yeah.
I forgot what though.
Microsoft Flight Simulator, they're releasing 2024. Why? Why make me pay for another flight simulator?
It has just career keep updating mode. 23. It has career mode.
I know, you can go and like rescue people from mountains. Yeah. The worst people on the planet. If you're going to go and climb a fucking mountain, prepare to die. Why are the SES coming to save you? They should just let you fucking die. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Because some people want to live, Peter.
I know. If you want to live, don't climb a mountain out in the middle of fucking nowhere.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah. If it happens in the mountains all the time. And those people are just like sitting at home with their families watching TV and they get a call at 9 p.m. being like, someone fell off the side of a mountain.
Climbers stuck on the side of a cliff.
Okay.
Pause maths. Yeah. I'm going out.
Oh, someone climbed up a mountain? Eat shit. I don't care. Fuck you.
Senua's Saga Hellblade 2.
It looks amazing, of course.
Yeah, looks
it
sick.
Looks incredible.
I'm so excited to see what they do with this because, like, it the first game was really like a B game. You know what I mean? Like, it was A tier, like triple A in its concept and story and sort of delivery, but gameplay wise, it was pretty B. And they were just working with the money that they had.
Yeah.
And it was such a huge success that now I'm like, they have a sort of large expectation to live up to in terms of what they're going to deliver with actual budget. But it looks incredible.
Yeah, this has been like the Xbox game since they were like, we're making a new console. Like, it's been the poster child alongside Halo.
I wonder if this actress has gotten other work or if she's just been solely taken up with this game, because like, she was there, she was originally hired just to like make their sort of developer video diaries. She was just like a like camera operator.
Yeah.
And then they were like trying to test some mocap stuff and they're like, do you mind jumping in so we can test this stuff? And they were sort of using her to do different stuff. And they're like, she's pretty good.
You want to just keep doing that?
Yeah.
See, I can really relate to this trailer because sometimes I get a little freaked out. And sometimes like I get a little nervous and like I hear voices in my head going like, to like freak me out. Yeah. So I can really relate
put
to that.
Put your face in a puddle. Put your face in a puddle.
Yeah. Trip over. Fall. Die. And it's like, oh. That's crazy.
This is like a documentary for you.
Yeah. Sometimes I walk down the stairs and my brain's like, fall.
Do a flip.
Go down the stairs head first.
Chat's angry because I didn't mention the Dune bullshit that's in Flight Sim as well. They've got the ornithopter.
Oh, yeah. That's right at the end of the trailer. So I forgot about it.
Like a Dragon, Infinite Wealth, butts. Yeah. We're not going to show the butts.
Itchy bun.
We've already talked
ass.
About it. Itchy's buns.
That's
we're
the
keen
first
on.
Yakuza game not set in Japan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kunitsugami, Path of the Goddess. Not for me.
I'm passing it to Will. My God, not everything's
to Will.
About you.
Looked interesting, but ultimately, I don't care about that.
I don't care about that. Also, Forza Motorsport. I don't care about more trailers. I don't care.
You know
about
who cares about that? Maybe my dad.
Games
can be a car guy.
Games can be great. Mm. I'll play it when it comes out. Trailer for it? I don't care about that. I know exactly what it is.
I actually got sad because I was like, say it comes out later because I don't want you to come out for my Pocket League.
Yeah.
So I could get a game up there. Mm. So when it was like, coming out this year, I'm like, no.
No.
No. Damn it.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. Is that an October one as well?
I think so, yeah.
Mm. We had a trio of personas. There's a Persona 5 Tactica, which is a tactics. New...
Yeah, it's a tactics game based off the Persona 5 world. It's got like chibi graphics. It's very cutesy.
People love it.
Yeah, I played Persona 5 Royal and I loved it.
Yeah, sick.
It was great.
Persona 3 Remake is coming to Xbox,
which
has already existed.
But it's not the full game.
Isn't it the full remake?
It hasn't got the female protagonist, and the female protagonist notably has some of the funniest optional lines that you can say. Like, you can just be like a huge, you can be a dick if you want to. You can just say, like, be so catty. For no reason, and one of the best parts about being the female protagonist, but they're not doing that for this one, which is a bummer.
L! Mm.
Massive L persona. But they also showed off Atlus had Metaphor Rifantazio.
That looked cool.
And this is a world exclusive reveal of what their next title is going to be.
I love that art style.
It looks dope as. I mean, I will not play it because I fucking hate this stuff, but it does look cool.
You sounded so earnest in the beginning.
We got
what a disappointing end.
Jusant. Yep. Which is about climbing stuff.
A game for Mark Serrells.
A game for Mark Serrells.
That is a Mark Serrells game.
This does look quite cool. I don't know how interesting they can make verticality in video games. Verticality is fun in sequences, but this
but I'm
whole
sure
game
he's
is verticality.
Slip a bunch and go, no.
Yeah, and what? And then he's going to expect someone to come and fucking save him?
A little turtle on his back will save
crossover.
Him.
Yeah.
The flight team come through.
You've got a little goopy guy that is your friend.
Yeah.
Mm. I think that's a really good thing. I think more games should have like you've got a friend who's like goopy and is just like a little guy in your backpack.
So yeah. Is there like a puzzle mechanic in like is there a puzzle in trying to get up the wall, do we think?
We really don't know what the game of it is.
Mm.
Puzzling.
And it's a metaphor for climbing. For existence.
Up. Go up. The mountain. I think it's like a bit puzzle-esque. Mm. But it's
I wonder if you can rappel.
I wonder if it rains and you slide down and lose progress.
Well, like we won't fucking know, will we? Recently. We'll never know. The game is not coming out.
Oh, okay.
I will skip one here, Josh, because we'll leave this to the last of the Xbox stuff. Still Wakes the Deep is a so spoopy looking trailer.
Made by the people that made Amnesia.
Mm.
Ooh.
Makes sense.
I had forgotten what Amnesia was, like, no joke. I was like, was that an Atlas game? No, that was Amnesia and the Dr. Sen stuff.
Made by the Chinese people. Yeah. And it's set on an oil rig in the 1970s, which is arguably the scariest place a game could be, a horror game could be set. Awful.
And the scariest time to be on an oil rig, the 70s. Can you imagine?
No OH&S.
Yeah. No railings. See that?
Oh my God.
Nuts. You're just stranded out there. No,
I hate that. I don't like being stuck.
And it's all
like
the option tiny, to go home. Tiny, tight spaces, but in the middle of the ocean. And then everything's like rusty and dank and has that, have you ever been in the underneath of a boat and it has that like gross dank boat smell?
Yeah, and it's even worse when it's carpeted, because it's like, why would you do that? Why would you put carpet in a boat? The carpet's wet. Who saw that coming? Oh no, there's piss in the toilet. What? Are you kidding? Don't put carpet in a boat.
Bilgewater.
It was a bad time. It was a bad time. We all agree. Dungeons of Hinterberg. People are calling this kind of the sleeper hit of the showcase. Mm. I didn't get much out of it, but it definitely looks like it's playing into that kind of funky action. I just feel like it's like a million games that have come out
Big
over the last
sword.
Couple of years.
Yeah. Mm.
It's all indie games, and now you skateboard and you shoot stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would argue that skateboarding is such a neat way to get around in video games.
Yeah, it is fun.
Because sometimes walking in an indie game is horrible because the walking speed is slow.
Yep.
And I understand that it's maybe to have a look around at the world. But if I can just get on a little skateboard and go, great.
Yeah.
That's true. You can power through past some of the...
It's a good point.
The naff around it. But Cyberpunk 2077 Phantom Liberty had its beefy trailer showing also Idris Elba, Keanu's back, V is back in action. Obviously, this game had a really rough launch. The public kind of sentiment around it has come back, swung back to the positive side of things. The journos who have spent time with this are lauding it as being a marked improvement still over what the kind of base game has been able to get to.
Is this a standalone, or do you have to play the base game to play this?
It is. Oh, that's a good question. I believe it's standalone, but it is a continuation from the end of the game. So
that was an expansion.
It's DLC, but you might be able to start a character.
Yeah, like a.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, yeah.
Like
no,
a beefed
yeah.
up. Yeah. Like a beefed
I can't
up.
Remember.
I'm pretty sure it's an expansion.
One thing. Okay. I think there might be some sort of character reset involved, because one thing that I've seen a lot of people talking about with this specifically is they've reworked. It's almost like a game rework. Like they've reworked skill trees. They've reworked how you spend points. They've reworked a lot of big things from the initial game.
Yeah.
And a lot of people are lauding that as a really, really huge improvement as well.
I think in this day and age, I just don't think that you lose out as a developer on giving people the option to do that, because if they're daunted by the prospect of playing the full game and then the expansion, then they're not going to touch the expansion. But if they have the option of being like, oh, I can just play this like newer, like bite-sized chunk, and then they get hooked on that, then they go back and play the original game. Mm. It's like you have more of a chance of hooking new people that way than you would trying to convince them to play two games.
Yeah. They're in an awkward position where they have not met any of the targets that they set when they launched the game in terms of content release. So they owe the players who have bought the thing, well, players feel like they're owed stuff, and they were not given what they were promised. But, you know, the game has been improving, and this is, by all accounts, a much more focused, they've kind of mastered their engine now. So they're telling story in a way that they were trying to in the game that they didn't necessarily land all the time.
Yeah.
So I'm really keen to play that. City Skylines has a sequel. Cities, : Skylines 2. People who like city builders are, you know, they know what to expect here. City Skylines kind of put Sim City to bed. City Skylines is the city builder. So cool to see a second one coming out. Towerborn. I kind of remember what this one is because I'm thinking of Clockwork Revolution while I say Towerborn.
It's Immortals Aveum.
The creators of Banner Saga.
That's right.
Yes.
Yeah, I remember this one.
This does look very cool. Banner Saga was a very well-received story turn-based combat game. So this is that with a cool tower in the middle.
That's right.
Yeah. And it's all co-op.
Cool.
Nice.
I believe, which is a nice little addition. Clockwork Revolution.
Looks very cool. I am, and this might be controversial, I'm a steampunk hater.
Oh, yeah?
Anytime I've seen a steampunk thing, I do not like it. It just gives me the heebie-jeebies.
Mm-hmm.
But that being said, I'm also a huge Bioshock fan, which is a very confusing way to live my life. But I think this looks awesome.
I think steampunk as like a genre peaked in the 90s.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
I think seeing it now, I'm like,
yeah. Yeah.
But that being said, this looks sick. As a Bioshock fan, I love this. As a steampunk hater, but also like turning back time, like taking the actual like kind of going deep into the steampunk-esque thing and going into like the cogs and time and turning time and turning time back. I think that is very cool. I think the very cool way to do steampunk that isn't purely just like, look, this guy's wearing a top hat and it's got a cog on it. Yeah. Like, it's cool. It looks great.
It feels like, I mean, it's very clearly aping, referencing Bioshock Infinite.
Oh, yeah, big time.
But I think it might have a bit of a Deathloop feel to it as well. This kind of like puppet master above all the time manipulation and you playing within time loops to try and work out the puzzle of the world and solve the riddle of it all. Fallout 76 has an update. Don't care. Starfield. Starfield had 45 minutes of the show. For me, it was it did everything that I wanted it to do. It showed me a Bethesda Game Studios game, and I'm always in love with the systems that they put in front of the player and just give you the tools to go and have fun in a just ludicrously stupid sandbox. They've got the humor, they've got all of the tools in there. They're building the space sim that so many other people are trying to do, have failed at doing, are still working on, not naming any names. and I think Bethesda may be the one to get us there. So I'm keen as fuck.
I think I like Starfield, but I think I prefer him if he was a little bit nicer to Odie if he cared a bit more about the fact that John takes good care of him. But I will agree with Starfield that Nermal is very annoying and I do not like it when Nermal is around. And that's my opinion on Starfield.
for those of you playing at home who aren't 80 and read the newspaper, that was Garfield reference.
Garfield reference.
I'll have you know that Garfield isn't just a comic. Garfield's also been a TV
3D
show.
Animated
Bill Garfield's Murray also film. Been a Bill video Murray. Game. Garfield's also been a Bill Murray who thought he was in a Coen Brothers movie, but it's actually not in a Coen Brothers movie. He was in a Coen movie that was Garfield. Garfield's so many things, actually.
To so many people.
So, yeah, and he's everything to me.
Will,
yep.
you're not a big Bethesda dude.
There
no,
is.
That's the interesting
Hi
thing of
Garfield.
Like. That's what I've got to look at now. While talking about, like, I don't. It's not the type of game that I have really ever played.
Yeah,
but I do like space, and like, you know, if I tried Skyrim, and that's obviously not a genre that I really ever fell in love with, and
yeah.
Fallout felt very samey by the time I got to it, which was like Fallout 4 and stuff, and obviously 76. So like this might be my into the Bethesda brand in that world as well. So
yeah, the thing about them is that none of the parts are the best version of that gaming experience, but there are so many parts that no one does a game like them, you know?
Like pulling upon all the threads.
Yeah. And they're a studio big enough to be able to execute it and that have been using versions of the same engine for long enough that they have the history with it to be able to go ahead and give it a crack. So, you know, I was only impressed by what I saw, so... Mm. It's just made me more excited.
And you can get a cool watch.
You can get a cool watch in a cool case.
Really looks really cool. Yeah. And the controller's really cool.
I know I said don't pre-order things.
The controller's
like,
so
for
cool.
That,
for
like,
I
cool
wish
watch.
I had that controller. Damn. I would love to have that controller. It's so cool.
Yeah.
I feel like I don't know if this will be for me. I feel like I've never really been super attracted to space sims. They always have felt very kind of... stark and kind of cold to me. I think when I've enjoyed space sims, it's like what I've actually enjoyed is the survival planetary stuff, which is like can really be any other genre.
Yeah.
But if the story is really good, which, you know, Bethesda do great storytelling, then I, you know, I could be
might
sold
be
on
the
it.
End,
It just it looks gorgeous. It looks it definitely looks more appealing than a lot of other Bethesda games.
Yeah. Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
Well, that was a massive showcase. It was like the longest one by duration, I believe.
Yes.
Yeah, it was so. 2 hours, I think, with the with the Bethesda stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. It doesn't really count because half of that was Starfield.
Yeah.
But then Ubisoft.
Yes.
Pretty cool. Sorry, I saw your tab.
That's all right. I mean, we'll kick off with the next big thing, really, which is just Avatar Frontiers of Pandora. Only getting to see actual gameplay. There was like a semi-trailer a while ago that maybe had gameplay in it, but this is the first look at it.
Yeah.
I'm not like the biggest Avatar fan.
Mm-hmm.
I am intrigued to see how big the James Cameron lore actually is when put into a video game.
Yeah.
Because it's like, you know, through the viewfinder of a camera, this seems like there's a lot going on.
Yeah.
But can you make a whole video game covered in James Cameron lore?
There's... The wet blue people and the hot blue people.
And the factory with guns.
Yeah.
Like, that's the thing that for me is still just, like, sad about Avatar. Like, the beautiful world that they present in this trailer and then cut to this. I'm like, okay. Yeah.
Is as deep as the frame that it's on.
Yeah.
They just need to leave these blue people alone. I'm assuming Avatar's a documentary.
Yeah.
And they're real real the guys. Suffering. And I think they just need... They've got a beautiful... Look at that. They've got a beautiful land. It's not... They kind of got fucked up because of these, you know, space people, humans. But I think they just need to leave them alone and leave them in peace. What? Like, I mean, it's never been good times from all the documentaries I've seen about it. It's
Which
never
will go
been
up
good times.
I believe 2032
people.
Now, I think, is when the last one will come out.
Have you guys,
like that.
Have you guys Wild. Seen the movie?
The documentary?
The, so, yes, the latest documentary.
I have. Not.
No.
Gotcha. No, I was scared.
Am I the only one that's seen it?
Because I was scared that they were gonna give the blue people problems again. Because I didn't like that about the first one.
Yeah.
They should have just left them alone. I think it was a bit much, and I think they should have left them alone.
It also got a date. it's coming out in December, so it's out of the realms of the October months, but still the back end of the year is getting pretty full.
I think it looks like it could be a really good game. I don't know anyone who was like super jazzed about the Avatar universe. Yeah. I think the first one was a technical marvel.
Mm.
People are super into Avatar. I've seen people on TikTok who are like, they are deep into Avatar. Wow.
Really?
They like level of like Star Wars fans.
Like
it's wild.
I guess it's just not in my zeitgeist then. Because I assume the latest film did well at the box office, but people are still like going to see it out of curiosity and again just for the graphic.
And the new one didn't feel like it like blew up and brought the resurgent back.
Yeah,
to have the fan base for this kind of thing.
I think too much time passed. I think it probably could have if it had kept kind of going, but I've seen, it's like those interviews with James Cameron where they're like, do you think people are still going to care about Avatar when these movies come out? And he's like, I don't know. I mean, I hope so. There's like, we got like three of them.
Yeah.
Like, he looks so unsure.
There was my favorite line. They were like, you've got like five more to write or whatever. And he's like, yeah, but like, if it doesn't do well, I could wrap it up in one. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
Then do that.
Yeah. What I'll say about the latest one is it was very similar to the first one in terms of like what it does for you as a satisfying film experience. It's like visually spectacular and it's like moment to moment, like there's a lot going on. But it pushes hard on the environmental message on this one, like really intensely.
I really love the idea of being like, yeah, our seventh movie's coming out in a million years. Just thought you should know. Oh man, I was really excited to see Avatar 7 at this specific time. But now I have to wait a whittle longer than my prepared time to watch Avatar 7. Like, it's so weird. Mm.
Yeah, it'd be like a date.
This forecast.
Prince of Persia, we could just go and have a look at that.
What date is that out?
18th of January.
Nice.
2024, which is cool. I like knowing, and that game feels like it'll hit that date as well.
Yeah. It looks pretty done.
Yeah. We didn't get a date for Captain Laserhawk, a Blood Dragon remix, which I thought was cool. And then I found out it's like, I mean, maybe it'll be cool, but I'm kind of tired of crossover clashes. It's taking the visual identity of the Blood Dragon Far Cry DLC and combining basically every Ubisoft IP into it. So like DedSec is the villain. There's assassins that are roaming the city.
Yeah.
Like there's a bit of all the different.
It's like a multiverse.
There was a rabbit just there.
I was about to say the rabbits there, and I thought that's going to be a really funny joke, Ruby. Yeah. But the rabbits are there.
The rabbits are.
It's
real.
This animator creative was on stage to present it.
Yes,
it made a bunch of YouTube content and got brought in by Ubisoft to make this thing.
Yeah,
looks like the coolest person on the planet. Definitely the most awkward person to present anything.
Yep.
And it was great to see Ubisoft back to doing what they're good at.
Yeah, it's like a half-baked costume and a dude.
There's a dancing party, some guy who does not know why he's there.
Yeah,
I saw so many people saying that about the Ubisoft showcase, like, oh, this is really awkward, but I kind of like that.
There's also a delightful bit right at the start. They showed a shot of Phil Spencer, and it looked like he was like, why the fuck are you filming me?
Yeah.
Like, I don't work here.
Classic Phil.
That's our friend. That's my friend in the crowd right now.
It totally felt like that.
Phil, look at the camera. Phil,
look,
come on.
Look, Phil.
It also is like got some Castlevania blood in it as well from the Netflix show.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. The same guy that was doing all that YouTube stuff, he worked on that first season of
Castlevania, which was cool. Look cool. That is it's spring later this year.
Mm-hmm.
Translated that as well.
Well done.
Fall. I'm unexpected, a new Division game, but it's Division Resurgence on mobiles.
Yep.
It's free to play. There's a beta to sign up for now. It's more Division. I like they were like, it's the same world, but a new story. It's like, come on.
I should play more Division. I feel like it's the kind of like...
It might be...
It's Destiny.
Yeah.
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 They're good games. It's just like...
Yeah.
Mobile Division... is not going to sell that well, like to a Western audience, but it's going to fucking do gangbusters elsewhere. So
it'll be like Crossfire.
It is what it is.
It's interesting. Ubi's wading into mobile, which we'll get to. There was a Skull and Bones sea shanty not really any new information on the game.
Cool.
But they did that, and there's a closed beta coming in August. It's cool. More cars with Crew Motorfest, 14th of September, filling up that month as well.
Yeah.
Set on a scaled-down version of an island in Hawaii, which
just
is...
baffled by Ubisoft's, like, release strategy.
Yeah. Just dump games at the end of the year.
Yeah.
Every year. They do this. It seems like nothing's happening. But then they're like, oh, like
we finished it all.
I hear stuff where they're just like, oh, Skull and Bones has been ready for ages. We're just, like, waiting to drop it at the right time. And it's like...
Nah.
Why?
When's the right time?
And then they'll drop, like, three games at once. It's like, what?
Focus.
The right time for Skull and Bones to come out was the year after Assassin's Creed Black Flag came out.
And before Sea of Thieves.
Yeah.
There's no time.
But maybe it's one of those things, like, you know when, like, somebody pushes a joke and then they keep pushing it and then it stops being funny, but then they keep pushing it so long that you start laughing again?
Yeah, like 10 years it'll be like, oh, sick, it's out.
Yeah, like maybe it's that. Like, they've waited just long enough that people are like, fucking, Ubisoft Pirates, let's go.
Maybe
someday.
No, Beyond Good and Evil 2.
Yeah, that's gone.
Yeah.
There's Assassin's Creed Nexus, which is their VR game. Coming in holiday this year.
You know what's crazy? It's cool because in Assassin's Creed, inside Assassin's Creed, you're kind of in VR.
You're right.
Because you go into the guy and be him.
That's brilliant.
And so it's kind of like you're doing that, but in real life.
Yeah. I wonder if you leave the play space, it says that the... What's it say?
What's your guy's name in Assassin's Creed? Like
Desmond.
When you're in the normal world? Desmond.
Desmond doesn't really exist anymore.
Right here? You're Desmond in real
Imagine
life.
Imagine if when you take off the goggles, you have there's another pair. Like
another
they give
pair
you two.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. You say put
one
on
pair off.
Totally. And you put on the game, and then you're Desmond in that shitty lab in the first game, and then you have to put on another headset.
And the best
headset.
Bit is, you have to you have to lay down to play the game.
Yes.
You lay down, put on the goggles, and it just do this.
What's Bill doing? Oh, he's being a super assassin.
I'm an assassin.
Or you lie down, and then you have to get back up as Ezio. It's like... Yeah. But you have to do that every single time you want to get out of this.
Yeah.
Like, it's really
annoying.
It's
actually a fitness app.
It's actually a horrible way to play the game, but they've done it anyway because of the immersion.
Get your crunches done, it's Ezio.
And then you just come out of it really sore in your abs. You got rock hard abs.
I'm intrigued to know, like, if it has kind of the movement of Superhot where you can kind of be anywhere, that would be sick. But if it's very like corridor, stab a man, keep walking, it's just going
to
be nothing.
The fluidity of Assassin's Creed will not translate to a headset. So
I want to see what it looks like when you hide in a
haystack.
A haystack.
Yeah.
Yeah. Can you, like, are you just...
Presumably you can hide in haystack.
You have to.
Surely, right? That's a big part of it. Can you jump into haystacks?
It'd be like
haystacks?
The side of the horizon where we got the bag over your head.
Yeah.
It'd be like that. And you're just like...
That was very funny.
Yeah. Because, like, surely he couldn't see anything inside of the haystack, right?
I'd like to experience in VR trying to run up the side of a window. Well, to go in the window, but then you run up the side of it and then you go back and then you run up the other side of it and then you go back
and then you jump out over the street
and then
you lose
half your health. Yeah, like perpendicular to the wall you jump and then you land on the ground.
And people go, ooh.
Why are you running?
He must be late. And she must be beautiful.
You might be able to do that on mobile, the Assassin's Creed Jade, which is the one that's set in China.
Yep.
Is coming. There's a closed beta coming soon. I'm intrigued. This and Division is so strange to me. Seeing these games presented here as a mobile game, I'm like, that's not going to work. Like, they're too big. Like, I know Genshin is kind of the thing that's kind of worked in that realm, but in my mind, I can't picture these games on a mobile.
And that being said, I have, I play Genshin. Not as regularly as I used to.
Yeah.
But, like, I've played Genshin on mobile, I've played Genshin on iPad, and I've played Genshin on PS5.
Yeah.
So, stark differences. Yeah, like, you can play Genshin on a mobile, but if you're playing Genshin handheld, you probably want to play it on an iPad or something as strong as an iPad or a PS5.
Yeah.
It, like, it can play on mobile, but it's not great.
I looked at this and I'm like, it should just be on a console. Like, it's just another Assassin's Creed game, so it's odd that they're limiting. But it may do well, like you say, in different markets.
Yeah.
It'll be pretty huge. Maybe later this year, early next year. The big one being Assassin's Creed Mirage, which the more I see, the more excited for just how simple and... Assassin's Creed.
It looks like an Assassin's Creed game, and that's a good thing.
Yeah, it just seems very sweet and like almost weirdly retconny, like Force Awakens, like where I'm like, I feel like I've done this, but I think that might be a nice warm blanket.
They're calling it an homage to Assassin's Creed. So it's like OG fans will get the core experience
totally
in the best possible way.
I thought it when I first saw the trailer, I thought it was Assassin's Creed 2 and they were remaking it.
Mm. Yeah.
I was wrong.
Well, I have been this is what I want. Mm. I want a 15-hour Assassin's Creed game, not a 60-hour Assassin's Creed game.
Yeah.
The only thing I would say is, like, everything I've heard about Mirage, I'm like, yes, on paper, yes, yes, yes. And then watching that trailer, I was like, it's hard to sell a thing where you're like, we pared back all the features.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Yeah,
all the advances we've made over the last few years, we're not doing any of that.
Yeah. It's like, it's hard. Oh, okay. Like, people often are just like, the oversaturation of Assassin's Creed games. It's like, it's supply and demand. Like, the success of those games is like, they've just been making as much game as they possibly can to meet the demand of Assassin's Creed fans.
Yeah.
People and playing them.
Yeah. Yeah. And like, and even though like a lot of us who play a lot of video games are like, oh my God, how am I ever going to get through? Look at all the icons in that map. There are people who are just like, fuck yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Totally.
This is my life. And that's like a large proportion of their base. But it's nice to know that they kind of have something that is like at least creating the core experience that is going to be uncluttered by everything else. And I think I think it'll do well.
And they got the filter.
They got the blue filter.
Which I think is so funny is to be like, hey, we are, you know, we're doing a little homage to the original Assassin's Creed. Isn't that great? Also, if you want, it can look like shit if you want it to. Hey, just an option. It can look like shit really if you want.
If you like it.
Yeah, if you like that. You can put it on it. Like, it's like being like, oh, we've re-released the Twilight movies, but you can have the option of putting on the blue vampire filter from the first movie.
I forgot how blue that movie was. Blue. Like, every now and again, it pops up on like free-to-air or something, or somebody even makes a TikTok about it. And I'm like, holy shit. So blue. Has a bluer film ever existed?
It is the coldest movie on earth. And then they were like, oh, that looks... No, let's not do that for the rest of the series. But like, what if they did? What if they were like, we've re-released it as like an ultra 4K Blu-ray box set and you can put the blue filter on everyone.
Blu-ray.
Actually, I take it back. That would kind of rock. Yeah. That would rock pretty cool.
In defense of that director, I think the reason why those vampires were not getting like, I was about to say burned up, but they sparkle, isn't it? Is because it was meant to be so cloudy and dark in the town that they lived that they just never, the sun never touched them.
So
she was like, she's basically using a day for night filter on that whole thing to make it, to sell that idea.
Muso for Hire made a really good point that made me remember something from my old job. It's not a true blue movie because a blue movie is actually an old timey term for a porn movie. And I found that out because
that's a bit blue.
During the height of the pandemic, I had an old Italian man come into my work. I worked at JB Hi-Fi. I had an old Italian man, this is Hart, come into my work and ask for blue movies, and I did not know what that was. And he's like, you know, blue movies, and I was like, blue movie, and then I got The Big Blue from World Movies, which is a great film. Great film. I got a copy of The Big Blue from World Movies, and I was like, this one? Are you looking for this one? And he's like, oh, and he picks it up, and he's like, no. And I'm like, do you remember what's in the movie? And he's like, sex movies. and I was like,
you're in the wrong
place. No, I'm so sorry. We don't have that. And he's like, okay, thank you. And then walked out so quickly. But in reality, JB Hi-Fi does sell like softcore hentai. So like I could have given him that, but I don't know if I want to get like a man in his 60s into
on
hentai.
Blu-ray.
I don't think that's right.
What a thrill for him though. I found it because
name them.
Name which?
I'm an etymology nerd. Okay, so blue laws were most businesses could not operate on a Sunday, keeping the Sabbath holy, one of the Ten Commandments, all that kind of stuff. Blue laws particularly, like they were kind of about the moral code of things at the time. So the term blue film or blue movie refers to the cinematic production that is contrary to the standard moral code, aka blue laws.
Yeah.
You know, in the late 18th century.
You know. PC Gamer.
PC Gamer, baby. It was long. There were so many trailers in this one. Yeah. It was long. And, you know, there were some hits. There were also some ones that were like, eh.
List off the shits as fast as you can.
All right. And we'll Frostpunk 2, sequel to 2018's BAFTA-winning title. Absolutely no gameplay has been shown thus far. Kill It With Fire 2, sequel to 2020's not BAFTA-winning chaotic spider-killing game. Spiders. Looks delightful.
Mm.
It looks heaps of fun. Because the first one, really fun. Jump Light Odyssey. That one is an out-of-this-world colony sim from the legends over at Melbourne's League of Geeks.
That looks
sick. You can pat pigs. You can manage a spaceship. It looks amazing. The art style, just loved it.
Yeah, it's super cool. Does this have a release date?
I'm not sure, but I think it's got a demo.
At least a year away. Yeah, there was something that was like, you can play it
soon. If the
demo's
not out now, I'm pretty sure it's coming out for Steam Next Fest.
Yes, that's it. There is a Next Fest demo for this.
Yeah.
Super keen to play it. It looks sick.
Very, very excited.
I don't know why this thought just popped into my head, but you know earlier today when we were talking about the turtle that fucks the croc and makes a little sound? And I was like, have you seen that video? And you were like, yeah, hilarious. And then you said, have you seen the pig? And I was like, oh, no. Yeah.
And I just showed you.
And you showed me a picture.
I just showed you a picture of a really cute pig.
And I was like, oh, cool. And then I just thought about it. I'm like, how are those two things related?
I don't know. You showed me a cool thing. You told me about a cool thing. So
it's like kids showing each other shells at the beach.
Yeah.
So Bjorn had two hermits fucking in it.
He was just standing there.
I know. I've seen the pig.
I showed this pig to everybody in the studio. It's a great pig. It's a really good pig. A big boss pig. It's huge.
We can look at it in the post show.
A post show pig.
Post show pig. Stick around for pig. Post
show
pig.
And then there's Road to Vostok, hardcore survival game set in a post-apocalyptic border zone between Finland and Russia. Okay.
PC gamer.
And PC that's gamer. That. And then there's I Am Future. On the opposite end of the spectrum, a relaxing survival game set in a post-apocalyptic city that's been completely flooded.
It's a goose.
It's goose.
It is goose.
There's cute robots in it. I played a demo of this game. Really, really fun. Really nice. It's coming out on August 9th. So that's fun. And then Warhaven, free-to-play PvP medieval fantasy combat game from the creators of Maple Story, and it does not look like Maple Story. It looks like something else.
Sure does.
And that's that.
I always find it funny when devs pivot hard in like a totally like different direction.
Oh, yeah. They're like, what if we made something different?
It's like George Miller directing Happy Feet.
Yeah.
And Mad Max.
But he had done Babe.
Or like David Lynch doing a Spider-Man movie. That would rock, actually. That'd rock.
Yeah. Ang Lee doing Sense and Sensibility, and then the Hulk.
Greta Gerwig doing Oppenheimer. Actually, I think Greta Gerwig could do Oppenheimer. I don't think Christopher Nolan could do Barbie, and that's my opinion. That's
what would Christopher Nolan Barbie look like?
Bad.
Sad.
Bad and sad. Yeah. And that's not what Barbie is. Yeah. Barbie is always happy and has fun every day, and Ken only has fun if Barbie looks at him.
Mm.
And that's canon. I read that today. All right, now we got Diesel Legacy, The Brazen Age. This one looks really neat. It is an online 2v2 side-scrolling fighting game. And it's got very cool, like, 2D cartoon graphics. So you can join up with a friend of yours and beat up another person and their friend. And you know what?
You can do that in real life.
You can do that in real life.
That's crazy.
Like, think about it. You and me, right now, we could just beat the shit out of you guys.
That's true.
And it would work because we're really tough.
Yes, please TOS. Don't. Yeah. TOS.
Okay. I can't say
you
that.
Could.
But I won't.
She didn't say she would.
No, I'm saying the act would be TOS.
Oh, yeah. I would never do that. I'm a pacifist.
At least just go over there and do it.
Oh, yeah. Off camera.
But you'll have to lure me over there under the pretense of something else because I don't want to get beat up.
Oh, but you wouldn't get beat up.
Wouldn't I?
No.
You'd be doing the beating.
Oh.
Yeah. But that would never happen.
No. Wouldn't that be a great consistent bit? We just have like a cartoon cloud of fighting. We just walk off and shake the camera and it's like...
We're just like consistently throughout the entire show. Amazing. There's like every scuffling now and then. Noises.
Outside.
And another thing.
Get out of here.
And then we got Dorf.
Nice. Oh, yeah.
And then we got Dorf.
No, yeah.
Dorf.
We got Dorf. We got Dorf at home. Dorf is an Age of Empires-esque real-time strategy game that is honestly making me mighty nostalgic for a cereal box adventure. That is a reference to Age of Empires sure being available in cereal boxes. Dorf looks sick. I think it looks really, really cool, like old school real-time strategy. It rocks my socks off.
Just jump halfway through these trailers.
Yeah, it's always such a build-up.
I know,
yeah.
So slow.
Yeah, check it out.
Oh, like yeah, that is classic.
Real, like, old school.
Red alert
strategy.
As hell, man.
It looks sick.
This is playing at 200%, by the way, because we've got 50 million more games to get through.
Yep, all right. Wait, so funny.
Show each of them, but we're not going to stop and talk about any of them.
Okay.
Just leave this screen up.
I'm also going to run them all at 250% speed.
Excellent.
Perfect. That's so smart. Sulfur, old school action adventure game that combines FPS mechanics with role playing elements. Looks very much visually like a Tri-Band Games joint. Oh, yeah. So What the Golf, What the Car, like that kind of, those kind of visuals, but an FPS.
What
it looks
the Sulfur?
Sick. Sulfur.
What's
it's got
Sulfur?
A freaking goblin in it. And then we got Stampede Racing Royale, 60-player kart racing 60. Game. What if Mario Kart was Fortnite?
This.
That.
That's pretty cool.
That's what it is. Islands of Insight, a shared world puzzle adventure game where you can do puzzles in an open world alone or with others.
Oh, yeah.
We were very confused as to what this was. We weren't sure if it was an open world, like an MMO where lots of people in the world were doing puzzles and you can join them.
Yeah. Like, is it like, can you just walk up to someone solving a puzzle and then just
solve
like
their
help
puzzle.
Them? Yeah. Cause that would be fucking annoying.
That would be so fucking annoying. Yeah.
Maybe
I
there's
think
like an invite system where you can be like, may I assist you? And the person can be like, yes.
I think
and then when
that.
You start solving the puzzle for them, they can be like, oh, fuck off.
Yeah. I think it's like you are in the world and you can invite people to also do the puzzles with you in the open world.
Or maybe games, there's like community game night. Definitely.
Yeah.
Maybe there's like a open world, like there's like world events or something that you can participate in that are like world puzzles.
Massive.
And
there is multiplayer puzzles.
You have to be in a party or something.
Yeah,
you,
cool.
You can actually do that in real life as well. You can do a puzzle on your own or you can do it with friends.
Or you can find someone across the street and do a puzzle
the
with them.
Hey!
Hey! Hey!
Hey you!
Hey! Do a puzzle with me! Finish this Sudoku! Lords of the Fallen. Remember Lords of the Fallen? Well, now there's Lords of the Fallen. Next! Nihil Bukes. Dungeon Master, a dungeon management game based off a French audio series from the early noughties parodying fantasy role-playing games.
You play Dungeon Keeper?
Ooh la la.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
It looks cute. Looks silly. Yep. I love it. Next! Mariachi Legends is a side-scrolling hack and slash that mixes Mexican folklore with classic arcade gameplay.
Sick.
It looks pretty.
Mm.
Yeah. It looks pretty. Warhammer Age of Sigmar Realms of Ruin is a Warhammer game called Warhammer Age of Sigmar Realms of Ruin. If you are a fan of Warhammer, you might like this because it's a Warhammer game. Citizen Sleeper 2 Star Wars Factor is the sequel to Citizen Sleeper. Citizen Sleeper rocked. And, you know, it's got that narrative focus kind of, you know, an ode to tabletop RPGs. This looks very much the same, but also more, and it looks amazing. Criticove is if you can do heaps more stuff in Animal Crossing New Horizons, and it's also on PC. That is what Criticove is, I think.
Yep.
Miasma Chronicles.
Oh. That was the warning for the next game. It was like violence, sexual themes. And I'm like, Criticove does not
Criticove?
Look like
in not in my Criticove. Miasma Chronicles is a post-apocalyptic tactical RPG from the creators of Mutant Year Zero, Road to Eden. Do you care?
Big thing. Big
is this the one that people are saying
you.
Is like Destiny?
It's coming out on June 20th. All right.
All games are like Destiny.
Yeah, okay.
Altered Alma is a
Final
Metroidvania. It's also a dating sim. It is a Metroidvania dating sim. The animation in this was really cool, but what was even cooler was the pixel art. The worlds and the characters both look incredible. You know, it's all pixel art.
I find that when they blend two art styles like this, it can be quite jarring.
Yeah.
I
But a space opera Metroidvania? Wow, we were. Invector Rhythm Galaxy, spaceship guitar hero. That's all I've got.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
See it.
Totally. Yep. Audio Surf.
Slime 3K, you're a big fat slime guy with a freaking gun.
Oh, that looks like Vampire Survivors.
Yeah, Vampire Survivors, yeah. Except you're a big fat slime guy and you've got a freaking gun.
Nice.
It's like role reversal. You're the slime this time.
Now you're the slime. This is The Invincible, which is, I think it's based on, is it Stanislaw Lem?
That's what it says here.
It's based on the story of, like the story The Invincible by Stanislaw Lem. And that's it's coming out this year. Park Beyond, what if Roller Coaster Tycoon was a little freaky and crazy? You can do how you can do Roller Coaster Tycoon, except it's crazy.
It's got, is that an octopus?
Got an octopus, yeah. And it's in space.
That didn't look like a physically possible roller coaster.
Well, that's
coaster
called
to have.
It the impossification upgrade.
Oh, got it.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, it's nice. It's crazy. We're going fast.
it's Parcel, getting faster.
Parcel Corpse is Uber Eats Simulator, and you can also do Sick Tricks. That is what we didn't get a huge look at the game, but they were like we got, you know, doing cool tricks and you're on a bike and that rocks.
I was disappointed that this didn't have an E at the end of it and was about delivering dead bodies.
Yeah.
Oh, what a twist.
Sad. You can't fit it in that backpack, but you can fit a delicious hot meal. Shadow Gambit The Cursed Crew is pirate-based stealth strategy game from the makers of Shadow Tactics. Mm-hmm. I like anything pirates. That's my opinion.
Let's talk after Skull and Bones comes out.
Yeah.
Okay. I like most things pirates. Stormgate is jam-packed real-time strategy from former Warcraft and Starcraft devs.
So XO1, we looked at it on the show last year. It was like a
little goopy boy.
What was that downhill surfing thing? That was an iPhone game.
Yeah.
But it was just about momentum off the side of like geometry. And they've built a rally game in that same like just big space like sandboxes. Mm. Oh, looks cool.
That was awesome.
Is this Stormgate or is this Tech Terra Worlds?
This is Tech Terra.
Oh yeah, Tech Terra Worlds is an open world PvE survival game where your cars. You are cars?
Seems like it.
And you're cars. And that's kind
of... You build yourself.
Yeah. It's like if you are a car and you could build yourself. It's like Mars.
But not on Mars.
But you're not on Mars.
Mm.
And...
And there's you can like shoot. Warfare.
And you don't have a banging soundtrack by Dan Golding.
Mm. Yeah. Sad. Couldn't be me.
No.
Soundtrack to bang
and
too.
And there's Macabre, which is from a Sydney-based studio, WeForge Studios.
It looks like photogrammetry.
Co-op stealth extraction horror game. It looks terrifying.
Yeah.
I think we got a first look at this last year. It's
What is that?
It got a Screen Australia grant. It was part of the game's expansion pack.
Wow.
And it looks fucked.
What the fuck?
It looks so cool.
Trust a Sydney cider to come up with that.
Yeah, it's coming from a Sydney studio. Hell yeah. You can see there's a little
Rue
sign there.
That was cool.
Love that. And then there's Last Train Home.
That's definitely a Hex's horror hijinks of the week.
Oh, that guy's face
another
is moving
ultra
in a weird way.
Yes, Last Train Home.
It's because it's sped up.
It is a real-time tactics game set after the Great War.
Probably during the Great War.
No, it's set after.
What are they fucking killing each other for?
Because it said Great War is over, but the fight continues.
It's over.
Yeah.
Go home.
Yeah, I don't know why this is
still like War of the Worlds.
Can I say something controversial? Yeah, brave. I don't care about war games.
Yeah,
I'm losing interest in them.
Yeah, I think.
Me too.
Yeah,
I think this area of war is at least kind of less covered.
Yeah, I think the train should have like a face on it and maybe be English, and the fat controller should be there.
Should be narrated by Ringo Starr.
Yeah. I would love to hear Ringo Starr's voice over that. Yeah. My Friendly Neighborhood. My Friendly Neighborhood, Burton, sorry, I wrote Burton Ernie are going to fucking kill you and Big Bird is going to watch and laugh. But it's like a mascot horror game set in the studio of like a Muppets-like
Muppets gone
world.
Wrong.
Yeah,
well.
But it's very, I would say it's Lep's mascot horror and it actually like based on the gameplay, it reminds me a lot of Resident Evil.
I wonder if it would make me this uncomfortable if it was at a normal speed.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm never going to play a game normally ever again.
Yeah.
It's scary. And then Bloomtown, A Different Story is a narrative JRPG mixing turn-based combat, monster taming, and social RPG set in a seemingly pleasant 1960s Americana world. Pretty. pixel art, lovely, but there's something mysterious afoot, something nefarious. It's actually some crazy freaked Fur up boys. Demons, and it's a crazy. It looks cute. Sand.
Say no more. Sand? Say no more.
That's it.
We in sand?
Oh, no.
Is sand?
I just probably made in Ukraine.
Is this sand? Yes. Yep. sand, open world, PvE game. Anakin Skywalker would hate this, am I right? That's what I'm talking about. Yeah. It like visually sand. It looked cool. Ah.
There's
sand. Sand.
That's it.
Cut to something sand. Else.
Good, good, good.
And then we got I ran out of time. This is Mullet Mad Jack. Yep. It looks sick. It's like a visual. That's done. It is a visual overload. It's an FPS.
As you just saw.
Very yeah. like,
it's a 15-second trailer.
I believe you'll find it's a 7-second trailer.
Gaucho and the Grassland. This is, another kind of like
Gaucho.
Life Gaucho. Management. Very cutesy. And then.
Dune.
Dune?
Gaucho is the is a Argentinian cowboy.
Mm. Yeah. And then more Dune. Sand. We got to look at Dune. We got more look at Dune. It's a worm. I liked the movie. I don't care about the game.
It's a worm.
Dune. It's a worm.
Not super excited about survival in Dune, but I'll play it.
Mm. I'm a firm believer of like not every movie has to be a game and not every game has to be a movie.
I don't necessarily agree about that.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
I would like to see Blue Valentine, the video game. Mm.
I want to be able to play.
That would actually make it a pretty cool narrative adventure.
Oh, yeah.
If you could change the
I want it to be a survival action game.
Yeah. I want to play Sandra Bullock and Ryan Reynolds, The Proposal.
The Proposal.
I want to play that game.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Dating sim.
But yeah, as a match three as gem match game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you also have to
proposal
fix up a house, and also you're a pregnant woman, and your house is on fire.
Yeah,
and you fell over in the mud,
and you've got a high pressure hose to wash it all down.
Yeah,
Devolver.
And I think that we're going in Devolver. I keep going.
I'll do it. I'll do it. There's only four games, so I want them. Wizard with a Gun
looks sick.
Looks awesome, and the demo is out now.
Yeah.
And this is by the guys that made the other gun one.
Umbrella?
No.
No.
Gunslinger.
Sure. Talos Principle 2, we already talked about.
Oh, that was light.
Good puzzles.
Puzzles?
Mm. Cool puzzles.
Yeah, cool puzzles. And this looks...
Light beams.
This looks like a great evolution of what Talos Principle did so well. Mm. Baby Steps is... a divine trailer.
Yes.
Bennett Foddy is back and he's got a chunky boy to deal with here.
He's thicker than ever.
Yeah.
It's a fat ass.
And just like just a grown man in a dirty onesie.
Yeah.
You just
falling into
it.
Mud all the time. And, who can relate?
Yeah. That's such a face plant.
And
oh,
so
no.
as you
oh, I love this.
Maybe saw there it is the Ape Out team who did that amazing artistic top
it's
down.
So good. And just getting a random Australian voice in this ad was so amazing. I loved it.
Super oh my gosh, cute. This speed as well for it is making it so, so much better.
And this kind of undercut Human Fall Flat, which followed, because Human Fall Flat is like a less funny version of this.
But it sucks because Human Fall Flat is such a fun game to play with friends.
Yeah.
It is so much fun and I can't wait for the sequel. And a review of the Devolver Showcase, The Return of Volvi. I am a Volvi head. I love Volvi. I think he's funny, and I think that I love the big hand for gaming. He's my favorite video game character.
There you go.
Yeah.
That was a lot, and it did take us some time to get through it, but I think we touched on most of the big games that have come out across so many fucking shows.
Yeah.
There's like, it's insane how many video games come out every year.
Yeah.
It's impossible to play them all.
But is it just because E3 was cancelled that we had so much crammed into those showcases?
Mm.
Because I don't feel like typically we get that
much of a kind of onslaught of video games.
I feel like there's a lot more because of it's the thing of like having a physical event. There are going to be less trailers just shown off and more games available to play on
for
the
sure.
floor.
Well, yeah, totally. Mm. Which is why I'm like, is it just because E3 isn't available for that this feels so stacked?
Big
or
time.
is there something else shifting in post COVID? Or is it just that there's more indie stuff that's being made because people have better access to make stuff? Or
yeah.
Milk Please is onto something with PC Gamer. You know, they don't have the cred to pull big exclusives. But there are a lot of PC gaming enthusiasts out there who are going to get all the stuff that happened in the Xbox Showcase and in the Summer Games Fest. But there's still this, I don't know, like tribal kind of affection for PC gaming as this other.
Mm-hmm.
And so the PC Gamer Showcase still exists. I don't think it's particularly necessary. But it is if you're talking about the fact that a lot of these brilliant games that are much smaller wouldn't have a platform in the Xbox Showcase and in the Summer Games Fest because Keighley's just out there trying to sell every fucking second of that show.
Sure.
As he needs to make it work.
Yeah.
And Xbox are just prioritizing the things they own.
Mm.
Makes sense. So seeing PC Gamer try and highlight some interesting things is good. They go overboard.
Mm.
Like there's too much shit to digest as you're watching it.
Yeah.
But no one else is doing it. They'll probably find a happy medium at some point as they continue to do this over the next few years. Anyway, let's go to another ad break, and then we'll probably go to bed.
Hello. Welcome to Keel3.
That's us. Will and it.
Thank We're all you, Will and it. Thank you, Key3.
Thank you, Key3.
Thank you, Key.
Time for the game frickin' plan, man. So strap in, it'll be gone in 60 seconds. Okay, let's game plan. Face off against speedy opponents around the globe in F1 23, which sees the return of the game's story mode and its antagonist, Devon Butler. Make sure to drive angry against that bloke. Get lost in the watercolor landscapes of Dordogne and relive your childhood memories while you recount them in your journal, because this is still a video game. Next, deal with the unbearable weight of massive nostalgia in the latest pixel-ripped VR game, this time sucking you back into the Atari-fueled era of 1970. Park Beyond aims to capture some classic roller coaster tycoon vibes while proving it's still wild at heart with the inclusion of the impossification upgrades for rides and attractions. That's not a word. And finally, Dead by Daylight fans, get ready to kick ass as the newest expansion, End Transmission, launches on Tuesday. It brings with it the Entities Realm, a whole bunch of new content, and not Nicolas Cage? That's on July 25th? Guys, that's what this whole bit was about. Alright, well then, that's the game plan. Good luck thinking of any other Nick Cage movie titles to fit in there, and if you can think of any, just put them in the comments below.
Australia, we've got something to tell you. We've got news for you. Gonna put some wheels in motion. Get ready, because we're coming through. The Vega bus is coming. And everybody's jumping. Tullamarine to Bendigo. An interstate free disco. The wheels of steel are turning and the traffic lights are burning. So if you like to party, get on and move your body. We like to party. We like to party. The Vega bus is coming. Paid for and sponsored by the We Like to Party Party.
Welcome back to the show, everyone. Thank you to Tom Hummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummahummah of Agabus with the game plan presented by Atimothy, our hero. We didn't get to ask Atimothy what they'd be playing this week, but we're pretty sure it's Grimace.
It's got to be the Grimace game. Yeah. It's a game that everybody's playing.
It's been so long, I forgot about the Grimace game.
Game of the year? Probably. Yeah. We also have to say hi to all of the raiders that came across from Bajo's stream. Thank you so much.
Bajo has worms.
Bajo would have...
Oh, you can get a chocolate for that. It tastes good. When I was a kid, I used to eat it just for fun.
Do they have any adverse effects?
I don't...
I definitely ate worming tablets when I was a kid
Maybe it wiped my memory.
It didn't taste like chocolate, though.
No, it was the worming chocolate.
They have chocolate now. And they definitely have chocolate.
Yeah. Where did you eat the worms this one?
No, I mean, Ruby and I are similar in age. Like, yeah. I guarantee you, I know what she's talking about.
Mine didn't taste like chocolate.
I used to eat that same chocolate.
Yeah, it was good chocolate. Like, I remember being... Because the thing is, my mom was like a bit of a healthy mom. So, like... Instead of lollies, we had fruit.
Psyllium husk.
We had fruit.
Raw.
Yeah, and raw psyllium husk. But like, we didn't have chocolate in the house, but we did have the worming chocolate. And so anytime I had worms as a kid, I would have the worming chocolate. And then there was one point where I was like, I'm just going to eat it for fun because it's yummy to me. And it's
how
the only chocolate
know
we have
everyone
in the house.
Chat knows about it. Everyone's like, oh yeah,
I had worm tablets, but they weren't chocolate. They were just, I bit into them. They were like just powder.
Why would you bite into the...
Well, I don't know, because
if it wasn't chocolate,
why are we fucking having this conversation? I used to smash vitamin C pills, though.
Mm. Oh, yummy!
I could go a whole jar of that shit.
Oh, that's not good.
Yeah, I have like these hair, skin, and nails gummies.
Yeah,
and sometimes I'll just like eat them
for hair, skin, and nail growth.
I feel like all of those are a scam.
It probably is. I just like the gummies.
Look how much hair Ruby
has, though.
I watched
a Dr. Carl video that was like, you know, you can't like
proof is in
all of these like supplements that are like collagen, and you take collagen tablets because like so you can put collagen back in your skin and hair. Turns out, like then the protein gets broken down in your body, it can't reform itself in your skin. Like you can't ingest collagen and like have it go back into your skin that way. It doesn't work.
Yeah.
Science.
That being said, I'm kind of hoping
no one's asking those questions except Dr. Carl.
The gummies kind of, I'm hoping the gummies have hair, skin, and nails in them. And maybe I'm just misunderstanding what the...
Oh, yeah.
That's what I'm hoping for.
They're made from, like...
Because I'm just a little freak. I'm just a freaky guy and I eat hair, skin, and nails.
Well established as well. We were going to do another segment tonight, but we did unsurprisingly go long on all the fucking games.
Yeah.
But so I would like to... we do have a sponsor we still have to thank, and I would like to donate the worming tablets were presented by Nicrotex.
Yep. Oh, fantastic.
And as always, we read a tweet from Nicrotex, our worming specialist on the show. And I'm going to read, there's plenty of great tweets. Mm-hmm. Follow Nicrotex on Twitter. Always a good time. This is a sweet one. Oh, shit. It's Absolute Hero at Ruby Inners. Retweets a Ruby video.
Oh,
that's me. I love you. I love you, Nick. Bestie. Mwah, 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 mwah. That's my friend right there. Thank you.
We got to see the pig.
Oh, we got to see the pig.
Pusher.
Can we get
Pusher.
The pig?
That's Pusher Pig.
Pusher Pig?
Pusher Pig.
Make sure compost show. We're posting hog.
We're gonna be posting hog in the post show. But we do have to thank Loki Cat, who is the sponsor of the post show as well. Because coming up, we got Loki Cat's is the lover of cockatiels and fine scotch. And we're gonna read some tasting notes about Loki Cat before we get into the post show. But I do think before, and I'm sorry, I brought up the graphic too quickly. We have to read the credits before we do that. And
you want me to read them? I have my glasses on now.
I believe I believe you should.
Yeah.
It's your first
it's
the first one I can read.
Yep.
Yep.
Let's do it.
It's my first show.
Let's do it.
It's official. It's a work here now. Crazy. All right. Special thanks to all our patrons, the mods, Gat, Syntax Error.
Stop
Liz
cheating and looking at the
Dahlia.
Ghost TV. Look at that one.
Yep.
Which one? Okay.
That TV.
Liz Dahlia, Sith Cat, Phoenix O'Lion, Disturb 778, Jex, Caboose, What the Shark, Snail XD, Lord Shadamar.
Take the glasses off.
Okay. Oh, no. Gus, Herd,
Yeah?
Wrangler.
Now read it like you are a little worm in someone's butt.
Exactly what it would sound like.
Now read it like you're a thick pig. I'm trying to think, what else did we talk about? Now read it like you are Jeff Keighley, who is so excited about all of Nicolas Cage and Gillette.
I am so excited to be here with my friends, Nicolas Cage and Gillette, my friends. E3, more like me 3. I'm Jeff Keighley, me 3.
Now, like Grimace. You can put the glasses back on.
Oh, can I put the glasses back on? Community hot boy Nicrotex. In my mind palace, Grimace sounds like me.
Yeah.
House Ben, Muso for Hire, Dinosaur Supervisor, Phil Tippett, Bird Supervisor, Loki Cat. I'm sorry I didn't say all your names. I can't read without my glasses on.
It's fine. They're on screen.
Can we have, before we move on, everyone just like go around and do what they think Grimace's voice would sound like?
Yeah.
Will. Say hi, I'm Grimace.
Hey, I'm Grimace.
That's pretty good.
Oh, God. Oh, my God.
Oh, no.
Hey. I'm Grimace. I'm like... I'd like to fetch all your nuggets for you, kids. Did you order the Happy Meal?
I've never been so scared in my life.
That's your man. That's your man.
That's your man.
Would you like fries with that?
Stop it!
Or you like the little apple fly? It comes with a small bottle of water.
I'm turning the mic off.
Or you can.
No. And that's all for tonight. Thank you so much for joining us today. I'd like, on behalf of Back Pocket, I'd like to apologize for that. That was the scariest thing. And there were some horror games tonight, and they weren't as scary as that. So anything you'd like to say for yourself,
I'd like
Pete?
To say thank you to Loki Cat for sponsoring the post show, which is coming up. Loki Cat is lightly smoked with aromas of summer rose, ripe pear, and fresh coconut, alongside aromatic peat with a hint of cedar wood.
He used to call
me. No!
No!
Stop
it! No, Peter, no!
Oh, the